Alright, it's on.
Hey guys, here's Level Up session 43. This week we are honored to have Dave Rapoza on the show. Hey man.
Hey.
Dave is the creator of School and Shark, his personal IP he's currently developing. Dave is also a freelance illustrator working for clients such as Bethesda, Hasbro, Blizzard, Universal, Lionsgate, MTV, Riot Games, and tons of other. Yeah, we are really, really honored to have you on the show today. I just have no words for that. I have never dreamed of having such a big name here. So, well, we are really, really, really happy. Yeah, we are also here today with Darek and Jonas.
Hey, guys. Hello.
Yeah. So, we are going to start with something that we started to do recently with our guests. So we are going back in time. We are trying to get to see early works of our guests. And at the same time, we will ask questions from our Facebook event. We have introduced a new system that helps us get better questions and more precise. So, you know, if you want to your questions to be picked next time the event is launched, go to the Facebook page and we will launch a poll so you can get your question there and people can vote for them.
Yep.
So, all right.
So, Dave, the voice is on yours right now. So.
Hello, hey, guys.
Yeah.
But, yeah, thank you guys for having me. Just to drive the point home about, like, you know, you're saying all this stuff about you never thought you'd have, like, somebody high profile. It's like, I just don't think of myself like anything great at all. Like, I just, like, every day I'm like, oh, man, everything I'm doing sucks. So, like, I'll show you. I'm going to show you right now what I did for, like, many years before ever, I guess, becoming anything at all here. Let's go through the history.
Awesome.
So this is actually like, can you see it?
Yeah.
This is a early piece of mine when I first discovered like digital, but this is actually further down the line. I don't have my very beginning because everything was on a photo bucket account and they were like, hey, would you like to continue spending? Like, I think it's like $60 a year or something ridiculous like that to have photo bucket. I'm like, no. So that's gone. But initially, I didn't really like know how to do anything at all. Like I, you know, like everybody else, I started my whole digital experience right after like high school. I got a tablet instead of my scholarship to go to college. So they were like, "Hey, do you want to go to school?" And I was like, "I can't afford it. I'm too poor." Mm-hmm. So I was like, "Is there anything else you can do? I really like want to get into using Photoshop." And they said, maybe we can use the scholarship money to just buy you that. So I got my first tablet then and started working in the computer. But even before that, I just didn't even really do art that much at all. Like, I used to spend my time, this is a really bad one, the Speed Racer fan art. Look at that sweet nose and lips up here. I didn't know what the hell I was doing at all. It's like Devo. The worst thing ever. But anyway, I didn't even really do art that much. Like, I used to rotate between, like, a bunch of different things. I'd make, like, short films with my friends. I'd do, like, all this random stuff. And then for, like, 3 months out of the year, I would draw in my sketchbook and, you know, try and get better and use Prismacolor markers to do, like, really bad anime drawings of Cloud from Final Fantasy VII.
Yeah.
So, like, that was my whole beginning.
Awesome. And
I only really got serious about it, like, I don't know, when I did stuff like this. Like, I really got into it here. I spent, like, 24 hours straight, like, doing this one. And this was, like, my first one ever. This was, like, in 2007, I think that says. But, yeah, I got into it because I didn't really feel like I had any other choice. I used to talk about this on, like, the Crimson Daggers, but if you want to, I'll reiterate. I got into really studying because I was a total idiot, and I used to steal stuff all the time. And I got in trouble, and I had to go to like court for a year, and I wasn't allowed to work anywhere because I had a felony on my record. And I was like, I really want to do art for a living. I don't have a degree or anything, but if I bet if I get really good, I could potentially do it freelance. So that's what I started out as. Like, just I was like, okay, I need to really get better. So I looked on the concept art forums. And I started studying every day. And just trying to figure out how to digital paint from what people had posted about their processes online. And I did that every day, like 12 hours, 14 hours a day, like just nonstop until I started getting work. But yeah, I would
there
do
you go. Suddenly, Wizard of the Coast.
Yeah, well, this is like, it's kind of out of order. But like, this is the study stuff I used to do, like when I really got serious about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, looks amazing. Thanks. Yeah. But this was like the first kind of time I pushed myself to really like focus and do something that was actually going to benefit me in some way. Like before, when I was showing you those other things, this was me kind of like winging it and trying to figure it out. I mean, like, I don't think that these are the worst attempts because I put them online, so I was somewhat proud of them at the time. But like, a lot of the things I were doing were so horrible, and I just never showed anybody. But yeah, I like really, really wanted to just become a professional. So the Crimson Daggers thing, which I think you guys know about, but like started out doing that just to push myself to study, and I started doing these, which were just, you know, it was a lamp. Like everybody always asked me, like, how did you get down lighting and stuff? And I'm like, I don't know. Like I didn't do anything special. I didn't even go outside. I didn't go to like life drawing classes. I didn't do anything. I just grabbed a lamp that kind of sucked, and I put it on an apple that was rotten on my desk and just painted it. And I would do that all the time. Like every single day I would do something like that. Mm-hmm. And over time it eventually became a little better and a little better until I could do some work. And eventually doing like things like this, and then like moving into doing a couple other kind of like monster drawings and whatever, I landed my first job doing Wizards of the Coast, and this was like the first thing I ever did really for a bigger publisher. Mm-hmm. And this was all grayscale to color, and then moved into doing like magic cards and stuff like that. But that was like the whole beginning of my career anyway.
What was the year? 2000.
This one?
Yeah,
2009.
2009. Okay, so it took you about 2 years mm-hmm. to get like a big gig, because Wizards of the Coast is kind of really, you know, something perceived as a bigger job mm-hmm. in terms of illustration stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, that was the first time I was like, I felt like I could really say that I was doing freelance for a living, was when I got the Wizards of the Coast job. Because before that, it was like nothing but struggle. Like the question of people coming and saying, like, well, how do I just like get into it? How do I just do it? Like, basically, what is the secret to doing it? And it's like, it's really, really hard. You have to kind of go crazy and like push yourself harder than you think you could with, you know, like the studying and like working jobs that pay like next to nothing. Like I was juggling like 8 to 9 jobs a month in the beginning.
Yes.
And each one of them was paying like $100 an illustration or something like that. Like, and I was spending, you know, because when you're not very good, it takes you even longer than, you know, when you start to get some skills and you start to understand lighting and you start to whatever, then you're not guessing so much and it becomes easier. In the beginning, I was spending like, I don't even know how many hours, like this piece alone looking at, I don't even remember it because I just spent the entire length of the deadline trying to get it right.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, that's my beginnings pretty much, to summarize it.
It's really
so. Regarding current times, let's just get on board that you are creating very high quality, you know, detailed piece. Usually, how much time are you spending right now, and how can you compare the speed to the years before?
Well, right now I probably spend like I'm trying to think of something that exists right now that I'm not going to violate anything. Well, for instance, if I did like a movie job or something like that, and I had to do photo paint overs, those are like 2 to 3 days.
From Pacific Rim, for instance, right?
Yeah, that was like an overnight job. That was ridiculous. Which is like you just wanna like claw your eyes out and be like, oh my god, are you fucking kidding me? You know, I can't do it. And then you're like, I have to do it. But yeah, that was like an overnight thing. And I had to work off of like really bad 3D models. But for a full illustration start to finish, like if I were to do a cover for something, or I'm trying to think of one that's I don't know, I'll probably spend like 6 or 7 days on it, and I'll probably do like 4 to 5 hours a day on it.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's a little different since I break up my time. So if I were to do it like this week, I'd probably spend 3 hours a day.
Okay.
On each client piece.
Starting from here, you actually tackle one of the questions we were about to ask from the poll we did. What is your art routine? How do you start the day? You talked about working the blog, so maybe you can elaborate on that.
Okay, so my current schedule is basically, you know, like how I manage my time. I divide it up into mini deadlines throughout the day. I found that if I actually set a deadline for myself in like a week, it's not really in my head. I'm not thinking about it. It's not important to me. So like I need to create these little focus periods every single day to make sure that I'm putting everything into each little project that I have to do. Mm-hmm. So I had this moment where I was actually on the plane to go to a wedding, and like I was like, I wonder what I actually have on my plate right now. So I wrote it all down, and it became this huge list. Actually, I have it right here. I can pull it up. So it's this list here.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of that is my own obligations that I just made up. So I was like, none of this is going to get done if I'm just winging it. So I did like this timetable, and I wrote down like, okay, if I spent 1 hour a day doing my comic, Steve Lichman, and then two to three hours a day doing my Starvale pages, and then like I spent, you know, however many hours on client work, and then like planning for New York Comic Con, planning like a tutorial thing, planning to write like a blog or work on my t-shirts. I have like these different timetables, and then I set, if every day were like today, how long would it take for me to finish each one of these projects?
Mm-hmm.
So I have like my next installment of like the Steve Lichman series. I figure in like 6 days I'll be done with the whole next like six of them. So, and then yeah, each one of them set up like that. So I have this timer that if I just go to I just go on Google and type in I forget what it is, countdown timer or something like that, and it just shows up in, like right below the search bar, and I just put in the hour, whatever it is, and it plays this little beeping sound whenever it's done. And it's super simple, and I keep it in the corner of my screen while I work. And it's just a reminder of, like, you know, you only have this much time left, so don't check Facebook. Don't go on Skype. Don't check your phone. Don't do any of those things. It's like you think, you know, every single person I've ever talked to, they're like, I don't have enough time in the day to do everything I have to do. And I'm like, that's total bullshit. If you were to get rid of all of the nonsense that you do in the day, like the useless things, like reading articles, it's like, don't ever go on BuzzFeed for the rest of your life. If you never did that alone, it's like you'd be so successful. It's like, just stop using those things, because, you know, if you really have something you're passionate about and you want to get finished, or a project, like anything, or client work, it's like, don't use that stuff, and you'll realize how much time is being taken away. Because even if you go on Facebook and say, I'm just going to look for a second, my phone buzzed, I got a message, it's like, check that message. That could go down a rabbit hole of you being online for another, like, half hour, hour, you know? You never really know what that stuff's going to lead to.
Whole day, 2 days.
That's a bad scenario. Yeah, Facebook became that really interesting phenomenon when you can justify it because you go there, if you have a community, if you have like people that you follow for art, you go there to see and appreciate art, but at the same time there, actually recently I noticed so much bullshit going on in terms of like stupid videos, horrible videos, like shit that I don't even want to look at, and I have no idea how it started to pop up in my feed. I have no idea really, and yeah, so sometimes you get to think, all right, I'm going to look for art for like 10 minutes, and then you see an article, and then you go check out things because you justify it, because it's collaborating to your art, actually, so let's do some research, right? Whereas the Photoshop is alone right there. Nobody's there. Yeah, that's my experience as well. It's a fight that I have to get into every day, actually. Yeah,
it can be like super tempting, but I don't know. It's nothing in the end, you know. It's not really anything that's going to like impact your life in some hugely meaningful way. It's just stuff to fill time.
Yeah, that's true. I have a second question. And after this one, we can move on to the demo part if you're willing to.
Sure.
Yeah, all right. So what's the experience or exercise you has been, that has been the most important for you throughout your development? Is there any specific thing you did that you found like a game-changing experience?
Yeah. Every single time I get bored doing, or every time I feel like I'm okay at what I'm doing, I'll have to stop doing that thing, because it's like when I become efficient, then it's boring, and for me, it like drives me crazy to just sit and do the same thing. So I'll try something entirely different. Like for instance, I was doing lots of like the heavy rendering stuff and trying to get the realistic thing, and it became like a formula to me where I wasn't really thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I heard a funny thing, like a comedian was talking about how if you're up on stage all the time and you're doing the same material over and over, you get into a groove of it, and it's almost like you forget the meaning of the jokes and you forget why they're funny, you just get into the pattern of saying them.
Mm-hmm.
And then it becomes a comfort thing where you're kind of forgetting like what the point is, and that felt like it was happening to me in doing the work. So I just had to like stop, and I went back and started doing like simple line drawing things and trying to develop like a something I wasn't comfortable with, like an inking style or whatever, like very definite strokes that were, you know, I wasn't like sketching around trying to like really work something in slowly, like loosely, like trying to find something. I would do these definite lines that would have to define what I was thinking in like one, you know, like a few strokes, like it can't be sloppy. And that was like a whole new way of thinking for me, and it got me going into the piece. And then when that became something I was comfortable with again, I tried doing like animation.
Mm-hmm.
And I still try doing that, and like I find that each time I jump into one of these different skill sets that I'm not comfortable with, it opens me up to not only like that challenge and having to grow just in myself, but to that whole other side of like art, like all the different people that are there, like all the different, like, you know, like amazing artists that you don't really get to hear about if all you ever do is like stuff in entertainment art or concept art, illustration. Like there's so many other amazing guys that you can just like learn from in the... Yeah, that's what I've been doing. Just so every single time I feel comfortable switching.
Yeah, so it brought you
in your comfort zone. Yeah.
Yeah, so it brought you on the way that you started also the Star Evil project, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you had the period that you were posting only that kind of illustration or pictures. And I also noticed in your blog post that it also brought you to the new clients that were interested. Only in this kind of style that you just developed, right?
Yeah.
So it's also very good because you show that you are versatile and you can feel more comfortable in, you know, in more challenging tasks that you thought are challenging for you and became something new for you.
Yeah, it's like when I was doing the rendering thing, I was focused so much on rendering and making things just look finished that it was bullshit. Like, everything I was doing, I mean, if I look back at it now, I'm like, wow, all of this sucks. Like, it might not suck on a fundamental level of saying, like, oh, the lighting works. It's like, who cares if the lighting works? Like, because it doesn't work as an idea. Like, the actual picture is so boring. And, like, I'm not even interested in looking at it. And I found that, like, when I had to do really simple stuff, like really simple drawings and things, I would be like, the only thing that this basically rests on is if it is at least an interesting idea, or, like, the design is kind of cool or something. So I would have to think really hard on those things instead of just focusing on getting away with a lot and making things look pretty.
So like, it's like a more creative process for that kind of, you know, speed pictures with line that you, you know, comparing to the rendering picture that you made with autopilot, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's just, you know, answering a different question. It's not answering question how, but answering question why, basically, with your artwork before you maybe... Like, I find it really popular among people that are starting out in this industry. They're really technique-heavy. They're really thinking about all the different techniques you can use, all the, like, you know, small things that at the end don't really matter that much. Of course, they matter, but at the end, there is only you as a designer, you as a personality, you as an a person that expresses things. So, yeah, when I look at your work, at the time when I discovered your work, Dave, you were heavy on the rendering stuff. I was really impressed by, like, you know, Turtles and all that stuff you've been putting out. But then after some time, I saw, like, this switch. Suddenly, your work became just totally different. But it was yours at the same time. I could tell. And it was really weird because at the same time, you changed so much of the... like rendering style, but in terms of energy and even colors, it stays in the kind of same world. Maybe it's because it's all created by you, obviously, but yeah, that's a proof that stepping out of the comfort zone should be done more and more by everyone that comes to anything.
I think it just like it's such a quick way to reset. Like, if you're feeling bored, if you're feeling like you've been doing the same thing over and over for, like, years, just doing something so drastically different. I mean, like, you have to be willing for everybody to be like, oh, that sucks. Like, first of all, because that's going to happen. Like, I don't know how many times I've read that. What's wrong with you? Why don't you go back to doing the good stuff? And I'm like, all right, that's just going to keep happening. Like, I don't care. I have to not be bored. Because if I'm bored, this is all going to suck.
Yeah, you have to have fun and be creative in the same, you know, time. Because it's like with creating the illustrations that have already set the design, right? And, you know, concept art is previously done and you are only rendering machine. But when you are doing something, you know, very fluent and very loose, it's you are, you know, the lord of everything, of every line, of every shape and every design. So it's also, quite understandable.
Yeah, it's so fun.
Yeah, so if you want to check out Dave's Sarville project, I'm just posting the link to the specific part of his portfolio on the our event page, so go check it out. And in the meantime, we can switch to the demo part.
Yeah.
So, let's see. Let's try sharing your screen, see if it works. All right, it's there.
Yeah, it's working.
Let's get these garbage trash images out of here.
Come on.
No, I have no mercy for myself. I think that, like, everything I did last month is, like, the worst trash ever.
It's the sign of improving, like, in a matter of weeks, then. Like, it's crazy. All right, so what do we have here?
I don't know. I'm going to delete this guy.
No. Just quietly remove that shit.
Just start something else. I don't know. We'll figure it out. Maybe I'll draw like a stupid knight or something. I never know what I'm doing, really. I just kind of like warm-up stuff for me is really important because if I just like I have a whole bunch of stuff I want to do. Like today, like I want to work on my comics and I want to do my client work, but if I just jumped right into it, it'd be half-ass. So I'm going to start out just winging it with some designs and hopefully get used to drawing with line again, because at some point in the night when I was sleeping, everything went the fuck away.
Can I ask you one question from our pool?
Sure.
What's the best art advice you have ever received? I think it's one of very important questions, I guess.
Don't ever show anybody what you're doing.
Okay.
I really do think that's the most important thing I've heard. Mm-hmm. It's in relation to like projects and things.
Mm-hmm.
It was advice about like if you're creating something, don't let it be seen before you really like know what the hell you're doing. So like, I actually just got this advice mm-hmm. the other day,
and it was the most important ever.
Yeah, it really was. There's different levels of importance. There's the most important now. There's the most important, you know, 3 years ago, and it's probably going to be the most important in like a year from now. But like, this one's super important because I feel like a lot of people want to do the whole IP thing and everybody's like sharing it and I'm guilty of that and whatever, but just don't show anything until stuff is at the printers. That was the advice I got, because people are going to judge it based off of your initial stuff, and if you change anything and they already like whatever it is, then they're gonna look at it and be like, oh, this sucks. I already wanted that other thing you showed. And rather than you just giving them everything at once and being overwhelmed by just the sheer amount of whatever it is that you did.
Mm-hmm. So how do you develop audience around your IP then?
How do you do it? My question as well.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I asked too. I think it's more about having multiple things going on.
Uh-huh.
So like, I'll have a comic that I can show at all times, something I can't show, and then just like something I just play around with, and random paintings that I'll post, and then hopefully that garners enough support in general that mm-hmm. I can just release something else that's my special thing.
I understand, yes. Okay.
What about if you want to do something where the community is actually an active part of the creation process?
I guess that's totally different. But I don't believe in like having the whole community be involved in my personal projects.
No.
I don't want I don't want to feel like I'm relying on them to be myself. You know what I mean? Like if I have an idea and I want to stick with it because I like the idea, then I'm gonna stick with it.
Yeah, that's yours, just particular. So.
Yeah, because the whole thing of you know, other people being involved like.
Fuck, you are so fast, man.
I don't know. I'm just do this stuff like all the fucking time. It's like my whole life. But, yeah, I don't know. I think that there is a benefit in the beginning to having like a lot of feedback from peers, but if you kind of know what you want, then it's, you know, like if I like that, what the fuck is his name? That Ford. But what he said about if I asked people what they wanted, they would have said a faster horse. About, you know, building the car. It's like,
yeah,
you just have to do what you want, what you think is right, and, you know, screw everybody else. Just try and figure it out.
Yeah, okay. I think it's also a matter of what do you have around to maybe somehow give you a tip or something. When you're doing some client work, sometimes the clients are, you know, very precise with the with the feedback, and you probably will agree with it. So it makes the work even better. Sometimes it's always, you know, like, I don't agree with it. Just, you know, it will be shitty, but, you know, sometimes opposite is just helping. So, yeah, I think it's just a matter of people that you ask for help or...
Yeah, I think it's better, like, I don't mean to say, like, there's nobody you should ever ask. Like, I don't agree with, like, the Facebook thing. Like, I don't think Facebook is an appropriate place, because it's like, you just have, like, I like to think about it like drive-by compliments. Like, people don't really care that much. Like, they're going to, like, go past your picture in 1 second, see it, and then that's it. And it's more about, like, what you like about the thing. And anybody can say anything they want. And it doesn't necessarily, like, apply to anything. And they might not even put thought into it. Mm-hmm. But if you have, like, a core group of friends that are really helpful and have your best interests in mind, then, of course, yeah. You know, trust them.
Yeah, trust. Yeah, go ahead, man.
No, you go first.
Facebook is a blessing and a trap at the same time. It can get you work, definitely, but at the same time, you're relying on the crowds of people that, like, individuals that are sometimes, you know, great people, but yeah, relying your whole IP on amount of likes you get under one picture is not enough, you know. It all comes from your own faith in it, I think, not amount of likes or shares from the picture.
And it depends what it is too.
And as they've said, if it's like a, you know, personal project, you need to stick to yourself, right? What you feel and how do you want to develop it, not just based on everyone, you know, else tips or suggestions, because it just can create that something you don't feel it's you, right?
I don't know. I think it's how you deal with it. Like, it doesn't have to change your mind, but it's always good, I think, to be open to other people's suggestions. And if you're creating an IP, then you're probably creating something that you want to sell or show to a large audience.
Yeah, it's so, like a test out before, right?
I think Facebook, whatever you want to say about it, it's actually a good way to test your demographic many times.
Yeah, but that's if you're unsure, though. If you're unsure in your own idea, it's like, if you love...
I don't think you have to be insecure.
I don't mean that. I don't mean you have to be. I just mean that, like, if you really love what you do, then it'll resonate with people that are like you, no matter what. Mm-hmm. Like, and sometimes artists' peers aren't the right crowd for that thing. You know, like, if you don't have, I mean, just in my own experience, if I don't put out, like, perfectly rendered shit, a lot of times it's, like, within the immediate group, it's not as, like, respected at all because they don't treat that as the same thing. Like, if I did anime projects and that's all I ever did, I wouldn't get the same respect as if I did, like, Applebot-style art.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
they might both be the same kind of good, but, you know.
The stuff you just said about creating something and believing in it, that, you know, artists, bodies may not be a perfect audience, and creating actually something for yourself rather than for your audience, or rather what you think your audience is so much more beneficial. I heard the same advice from one of the interviews. I think you know the director, Darren Aronofsky, the guy behind Black Swan and the recent movie Na and Requiem for a Dream, The Fontaine, a really brilliant director in my opinion. And he was asked, what's the advice you would give to beginner filmmakers? And he said just that, create the movie you want to watch and it will find an audience. But we'll find there are people like you around the world, and actually I think there are a lot of people that feel the same about the same things, and the thing you create can actually bring them together in the same experience. So that was actually cool reminder.
I think it's kind of like, you know, a lot of times if you ask people exactly what they want or if this is good enough or like whatever, it's like they're going to come from multiple places. It's like they might be coming from a place of protecting you and saying like, I don't know if this will work. Like, I don't know the amount of times I ask, like, you know, it's like you ask your parents, like, should I do art for a living? Mm-hmm. Every single person's going to go, oh, fuck no. It's the same kind of thing. It's like, should I do this? Well, that's not really, like, proven. I've never seen that. Like, you know, people don't like that stuff or whatever. And then you're judging it based off of somebody's fear that your thing might not work out versus, you know, it's like you never know where somebody's coming from, unless, of course, they're your friend or, you know, they have your best intentions. You know, they, like, know you. They know what you like and all that.
Yeah. It again comes to the audience that you are asking for, like, you know,
if which is have... yourself, which is yourself basically.
Yeah.
In this case, it should be you, and that's where the truth, I think, like truth in terms of expressive, you know, stuff you create. You know, you can tell when somebody is mimicking someone. I did that as well. I tried to be somebody else for such a long time, but at the same time, when you will stop being scared all the time. Stop relying on other people's opinion. You slowly become your true
free.
yeah, free basically. Yeah. Free from influences. Free from fashion. Free from yeah.
But I think that's very valuable though. I remember there was like a witch hunt after Wesper did like his whole sketchbook thing and Daniel Chavez and everybody was like, you know, saying like, oh, don't do like that, you know, like you're just the clone of these people. And it's like, well, you know, how many people were clones of how many other people before Facebook existed and you didn't get to see their work until they were who they are now and they're great. It's like there's so many people who come out of, you know, copying other people and grow into themselves because they were like, it's totally okay to have influences.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it goes naturally anyway.
Yeah, I mean, we all learn, like, I had that same question in, like, a previous interview about how, like, you know, don't you think it's wrong to, like, take it from somebody else, like, take a style or whatever, and, you know, just to even think about language or any skill, it's like you take it from somebody who already knows it, and mm-hmm. you adapt it, and you take it through your own filter, and you know how to use it, and it becomes yours, but, like, initially, sure, it was somebody else's thing. Yeah.
Yeah, and just because it filters through you, eventually it evolves to something else anyway. It's right. Kind of like what we've talked about this before on the show, but the concept of everything is a remix.
Right.
Wojtek, I think you remember you mentioned that documentary sometime. It's very interesting to watch to sort of understand how ideas always flow from other ideas, but to something new.
Yeah. It's all based, it's all the base at some point on something that was created already. So
yeah, that was a great documentary. If, you know, people watching this haven't seen it, it's on YouTube for free. Just go watch it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely go watch it. And then you won't.
Everything is a remix, right?
Sorry?
Everything is a remix.
Yeah.
I think that's what it's called, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was eye-opening experience, actually. So I will. There is a whole page devoted to the series, so let me actually post it in the event page. If you're watching it, if you have no idea what's happening, this is Level Up, go to Facebook or just type in fusroda.com into the browser and you will find out. Yeah, so I'm just posting the link to our event page on Facebook that you can find throughout our website, fusroda.com.
I wanted to ask you guys, when I was doing the Crimson Daggers stuff, like, it helped me in so many ways to just have a better understanding of, like, what I do. How has this helped you guys?
The whole thing.
Yeah.
It's very tough. It's like very tough, but at the same time, very valuable question, I guess, because I think that we also evolved as an artist. We just met a lot of new people. We just seen new workflows, new techniques, and basically wanted to be better, and we also wanted to level up, right? Basically, I think it all comes with, for instance, with language that is still very shitty, but I really feel it really helped me. Developing myself in this way, and the same with artistic way, because we have the guests that are inspiration for us. As I can, you know, want 100% true said about you, Dave. And when we get you on board, it was quite coincidence because someone just messaged me that you mentioned about us on your live stream. And I thought, oh, it's a chance. So we get there. And we were quite happy when you just confirmed that you are, happy to be with us. And yeah, it all comes with also with the guest. It all comes with overpaints that we wanted to do better all the time. It also, we were for me, it was the first time that I showed my workflow somehow in the first sessions. So was quite nervous at the beginning, but you also became more used to show yourself and show your face, show your personality, associate with other artists. And we also, made good relationship, good friends. And I think it's a very strong team behind the Level Up, and I hope it just, goes, farther. So, yeah, it's my point.
What about you, Jonas?
Yeah, it's interesting what Darek was saying about the sort of social aspect, because it actually helps you develop a little bit, well, for me at least, as a person on a level that's outside of the online world or the artist world.
Yeah. Outside of the cave.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a dangerous thing when you're just like constantly in your own world.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Go ahead.
No,
that's it. I was about to ask, what about you, Wojtek, because we just interrupted you. So
No, it's okay. I mean, for me, it was, it all happens still in our rooms, right? It's not really an experience. It's not really a physical experience like a workshop. So it's a little bit different, and it's like an inner journey we had to, we made with this. I got to meet my idols, basically. I got to create with Jonas and Darek. I got to create a community that is just extraordinary. I'm really proud of every person that is contributing to it. Every single second when the critique is posted or another artwork is posted, I'm just so happy that actually willingness to share and willingness to help and collaborate produced an effect, because sometimes without money, without infrastructure, you may have a good idea, but it may not work.
Yeah, but the interesting thing is that it's actually run, Level Up is actually run by the members, not really by us per se, because if we go to the group, we can just see that people are actually taking over the spirit that we're trying to convey, but doing it, without anyone telling them, they're just doing it freely. We started the hangouts, the permanent hangouts as well, 2 days ago, and it's been pretty insane to see how people just
Can you introduce maybe?
Maybe let's do some talk about it. Maybe you want to share a screen, Jonas, or
I can show the website for those who haven't seen it. Just give me a second.
So for that moment, Dave, you are just cleaning out the first initial lines and create some more details, right? The sketch before.
I'm just like pretty much just winging it. Like I'm doing just my simple finish lines on top of my sketch just to feel everything out, and then I'm going to do some colors, and I'll probably do another couple portrait dudes. I usually do like these because they're pretty simple for me, but then because the comic ends up taking a ton of time with big scenes and stuff, so
yeah,
to also do like a quick head is pretty fun.
The also thing is that you are removing the portrait that I would definitely save for later. All right, Jonas, maybe I will share the screen, your screen, right?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. The screen is on yours right now.
Well, basically, we've updated the website a little bit. And we added a new section called Hangout, for those who don't know it yet. And if you go into it, you can join one of our one of our two permanent Hangouts. And it's basically just the same kind of Google Hangout like we're using right now, but anyone can join. And you can have 10 people in one room. There's probably people in here right now. Let me check. Ooh, Inception. There we go. There's 9 people in here. So.
Nice.
And, yeah, so for people who've never used Hangout, it's pretty easy. You just need to install a little plugin in your browser, and you can just, you know, hang out together and share your screen or use the chat or talk. You can also watch videos together. Maybe you can even watch Level Up together. I'm not sure. You might be able to.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah, because you can actually just, you control one video on YouTube all together, so you can all watch it together. And then you can talk smack about us without us knowing.
Yeah,
so,
that's perfect.
Yeah.
Nice.
So yeah, check it out, guys, if you want to meet other artists or if you want to hang out with other artists. You can just leave it open when you're working if no one's in there. And then, you know,
jump on those pretty often with Darek and Jonas.
Yeah, we are jumping from time to time. But those, yeah. So I couldn't even join at night. The two rooms were full, so.
You guys are locking us out.
Yeah, so definitely maybe we will also think about creating more rooms in the future.
Yeah, we'll see. This is kind of the beta test right now. So
yeah, it's a testing out for you people. So.
It's funny, Jonas, but people are mentioning that you sound totally different. Maybe let's talk about the reason.
The reason is that you lovely people bought me this huge metal dildo that works as a microphone. And suddenly, you can hear every annoying nuance in my voice. Great.
No, actually, you know, I just used headphones before the session started, and as I couldn't tell the difference using my regular laptop speakers, obviously I couldn't hear the difference.
Okay.
Now I can clearly hear that the quality is much better. Darek is also using a new microphone. Mine is shipping, so I think next week will be all a little bit clearer. So
it's probably in customs somewhere at the Czech border.
I don't think so. All right. I don't know. Let's
jump back on Dave.
Yeah, Dave, going back to the process, can you talk a little bit about how you developed this look you have in the Starville? Because I think you're going for the same kind of feel here, right?
Well, this is like a simpler one. I actually use this kind of approach, which, I mean, I guess it's pretty similar, but the lines are smaller and it's more like pencil-y. I use this approach for my like concept art jobs. So all my concept art jobs kind of look like this, and thanks to Starville, I've had like the opportunity to do a whole bunch of them. And I'm pretty excited about sharing eventually. I don't know when that's going to happen, though. But I came about the process when I was in Germany. I got stuck there for a little while, and I was hanging out at Six More Vodka, and I was watching Marco draw on the computer. And he has like the coolest pencil brush, and I was watching him just, I was like, wow, that's so organic looking, like I love that. Uh-huh. And the first thing I did when I got home was I tried to replicate it. I don't have his brush or anything, so I was just trying to figure it out on my own, and I found like this sort of inking brush that was, it wasn't the same, but it felt like how I kind of wanted my images to feel. And we had talked a lot in his studio about like our influences and things and stuff that we thought was really cool that we felt like wasn't getting enough attention. And I was thinking a lot about like Otomo and like the old like 90s comics I used to love, and you know, now I would probably think aren't that great, but I was like, I want to take in all those influences and make something out of it. And so me and my friend Dan had started a Bloodsport challenge for the Bali Illustration Workshop, which was called Starville, and we were going to have people like design an American-style box art for the initial like Japanese release in America. So it would be like if an anime came over here and they Americanized it like all the old video game box art.
That's great idea.
So, yeah, like people did that, and me and Dan were laughing about, like, what if we actually made this a real thing? And I was like, you know what, fuck it, I'm going to make it a real thing. So I was like, I'm just going to make a comic out of it. And started from there, and I used that style on that, and it kind of evolved and changed over time, and I feel like I'm pretty fluent with it now. Like, I can run with it when I'm doing my comic pages. I'm still learning how to do all that. Like, I don't think I'm great or whatever, but it's a lot of fun, and yeah, I just wanted to have a more, like, realistic kind of inky feel on my work.
I find it amazing how you can draw like that on a tablet. Like, to me, I used to do a lot of anime stuff and more comic book stuff before I went digital, and it always felt really nice with pencil and paper, but for some reason on a tablet, I just can't really get that same feeling out of it. You're probably just used to it from doing it so much, I guess.
Yeah, like, I know what you mean, though. When I first started, like, trying to do this, it was such a pain in the ass. I'd be like, fuck this, I'm sketchbook. Like, I'm totally done. Like, I don't need this. But, no, I had to, like, I had to just get used to it, because my whole point of it, I mean, my whole point was that, like, I saw the way Marco was doing it, and I was like, that's so cool. Like, I don't know how to do lines like that on a computer. Like, I just don't get it. And I just kind of forced myself to sit down and learn it and just get used to it and try and get more confident with it, because I feel like, to me, the brush strokes, like the loose brush strokes and everything I had in my work, wasn't like, it stopped being a style preference and it started being a crutch, where like I was saying, oh, you know, this is just my style, this is just what I do. But in reality, it was like, I'm too afraid to really make any real decisions here, so I'm going to make believe like there's detail everywhere. If anybody ever asks me, like, hey, could you turn this into a concept for a movie? I'd be like, it's just ornate. I don't know. So, yeah, like, it forced me to make real decisions, and that was the most uncomfortable part.
But, dude, that's what we do all the time. Then we let other people solve that problem. Like, modelers and, you know, compers.
And then they love you, right?
Yeah, and then they talk shit about you behind your back. Those damn concept people.
They don't know how anything works.
They zoom in on your image and there's nothing there. It's just all this mush of crap. We just force. It's the same with like 3D models, you know? We just take like Kid Bash and just go. It's like making a potato stew or something. Then someone has to make it back into clean potatoes somehow.
I know. Somebody has to find the idea and all the bullshit.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, what is this? Is this even an idea? Is this just scribbles?
Yeah.
For me, it was always scribbles. Yeah. Sorry, 3D artist.
So, are you working on a Cintiq, or are you using a regular Intuos tablet?
Just a regular Intuos.
Yeah. Have you tried Cintiq before?
I'm going to get the companion. I've tried the old Cintiqs. I haven't tried the newer one.
Yeah.
Well, it's not really that new, but the newest one.
Yeah. So, have you liked those?
The old ones are shit. I felt like I was like, I don't know, like, you know, like when you go to a museum and they have like that glass plate over the map, it's like, what it felt like I can't draw on the map. I'm drawing on this stupid glass plate that's like hovering 2 inches above it.
Yeah. Yeah. Weird feeling.
It just didn't feel normal. Like this, like the Intuos, even though there's an initial weirdness to it, it feels more like a one-to-one thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's it's different. I haven't tried Cintiq yet. I'm wondering what's the experience on a Companion or a Surface Pro. I was wondering about it. Actually, I was looking for some, mobile, more mobile than a laptop. So something between a tablet and a laptop that could get work done on the go, if I'm traveling or because laptop is a little bit too much. You know, a laptop and a tablet you have to carry around. It's not really portable.
Dude, I carry a laptop and a tablet and an iPad and a camera with like five heavy lenses everywhere.
Okay, it doesn't mean it's necessary to do the same quality work.
No. And it all, but it does mean you have a hernia. It does mean that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I need the companion. Thing's like looks really good.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'd be interested to see exactly how much battery life you get out of it if you get proper brightness. I'm wondering for plein air, it would be very cool.
Yeah, I was testing out this Surface Pro 3 recently at one of the shops, and it's super bright and it's lightweight. It's actually a little bit smaller than the companion. So I find it, you know, companion felt a little bit too big for me, like to get, for example, to some planer. So I don't know. I just have to look for something like this. But Surface Pro looked really good. In the first place, it's a, you know, like companion. It's a full Windows experience.
Okay, that's cool.
From it, and it has really high resolution. So it's like 2K you get from it.
Yeah. So, I think I may be just too used to the benefits of an actual computer, like a keyboard and a mouse, that I find it really hard to properly work on a device like a
tablet. Yeah, I was worried about this as well. Like, how do I select the brush? I don't want to click these icons.
Yeah, all the shortcuts that you already know and you are used to it.
I'm totally bringing a keyboard with me if I have a companion.
Yeah,
the keyboard is just so essential.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about, they have really small, portable, slim keyboards that you can attach to tablets and stuff. They look really good for this type of things. You don't really have to get a keyboard with an unlock and all the numbers. They're short.
Maybe if you're traveling, you could actually get one of those roll-up keyboards. There's some decent ones. They're a bit more expensive, but you can just roll them up. They take up no space.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Have you guys seen those like laser-like keyboards?
No.
Oh, yeah.
They they're projecting. The keyboard.
Yeah. Oh, okay, yeah.
But then you need the flat surface kind of to get this going. Or maybe you can
it's just like. I was just wondering why anybody would use that. Because you just want to look like you're from the future. Like,
yeah, it's totally sci-fi, man.
You're like, here, beat me up. This is the beacon.
That's some nerdy shit right there.
That's like people walking around with Google Glass. It also seems really weird to me. Like, working with this freaking computer on your head everywhere.
That's the most ridiculous thing ever. You see that thing on The Daily Show? I don't know if you guys watch that, where they had that guy who was wearing the Google Glass. It was like a whole group, and they were talking about how, like, people were, like, getting in their face, like, stop, are you recording me? Like, stop recording me, like, in public. Like, it's just like Google Glass, and they're, like, assaulting. I was like, yeah, exactly. Like, if anybody just came up to me recording my stupid face with their glasses, I'd be like, get the fuck out of here. It's the craziest shit ever.
But, yeah, I guess that's what it's going to, you know.
It's weird. I hope not. I don't want to wear that.
Augmentation. No sex.
Only with plugins.
Alright, let me get some questions.
Yeah.
I think we have some good ones. Alright, so when you have hit the wall in the project's careers, am I pronouncing it right? So when you have hit the wall in project areas, basically you have really like in a hard project or something you're really stubborn about, how did you get through or get over it in terms of projects, career moments? What are the things that help you get out of the void?
Well, I don't blame the project, first of all. That's my number one thing. I used to be like, well, this project just sucks. But then I'm like, my whole fucking job is to, like, get past this. Like, I'm supposed to be the person that can find a good idea and the worst thing ever. So, like, it's getting past that, first of all, like, the sort of hatred for the thing. Because I think a lot of times you get bogged down in a job or something because you don't know where to go with it. You're just like, ugh. But that's more you, I think, than anything else. So it's, like, expanding that sort of, I don't know, like figuring out what that problem is, like what's the real issue here? Like, can you just not draw this stuff? Like, do you not have the knowledge for it? And then just keep, I mean, ultimately, I think the thing that makes it so you don't ever really feel that is constantly trying to improve yourself. If you're constantly working and you're constantly like pushing yourself to try new things and grow, you never hit that wall because there's always a solution. There's always a way to get through it. It's you're limiting yourself when you say, like, well, that's just it. That's the end. You know, I don't know what else can happen here. It's like that's you giving up. So that means you don't know something, or like you're unaware of a solution. So you have to figure out what that is and move past it, because otherwise, you know, you're your own worst enemy in that case.
Mm-hmm. And the worst thing is that you are, you know, giving up yourself at in the beginning when you even didn't try, right?
Hmm.
I mean, you can have an issues later in the project. Doesn't mean you have to stop at the beginning. You know, it comes different moments, really different moments. Like, it can come at the beginning, it can come at the end.
Mm.
It can come with revision or with a brief, whatever. Yeah, so I think, yeah, it's a great answer just to... Yeah, projects will come and go. They have really different briefs. And what do you think would happen if the same brief would be approached by a different person? Probably different problems, different approach. Maybe not as many issues as you have, or maybe even more. So it's a personal thing, that's true.
Yeah. There is some interesting question in the chat. Maybe this one, I will get this one. From Ivan Gonzalez. How do you choose colors on Star Evil? Do you have any method or particular theory on it? Because I also noticed that you have sometimes very original color, you know, on different characters. So do you have the concept behind it, or you just go and flow with it?
I go with the flow as far as like just kind of eventually like ending up somewhere. And then it becomes the color for whatever that character is. But initially, when I'm picking colors, I'll do, you know, I won't go beyond three different tones. So I'm not going to introduce more than three colors. And I don't mean to say that I'm going to choose, like I'll just show you right here. So this green that's on his, like, main form, if I choose the green, the jacket might go, like, off here and then a little off that. And then that'll be, like, more of it. So I won't, like, I won't go too far from that green. And that's basically what I do, is I try and keep each section of the character, like, pretty close, you know, to the base color without, like, suddenly, like, jumping into some really strong contrast. And then I might add like one spot that's the focal point of the whole design, and that'll be the one that has like either the most contrast or the one complementary color or whatever else. But yeah, beyond that, I just try and choose colors that I don't think work. Because my comics has like a lot of action and stuff, I was like, what if it's like pink all the time? Like, nobody wants like an action-packed comic that's like pink. And I was like, I bet nobody really does that. So I was like, I'm just going to do that. I think it'll be funny.
Yeah. The only person that I can think of with really crazy colors and comic styles, Mobius. Like, really crazy stuff. Like, crazy contrasts, crazy color contrast, basically. Yeah. Can get really trippy sometimes. Really trippy. Like,
I like to create like contrast and tone, though, like and not tone in like colors or value, but in like the mood of it. So if it's like if it were like a really dramatic thing, I'd want to go for like super bright colors and see what that does.
Yeah, it's a cool way of experimenting by just doing the opposite of what you're supposed to do to complement an emotion or a feeling.
Yeah, it's definitely like fun to feel it out and be like, does this work? Does it not work? Am I just being an idiot?
It's like, for example, with horror, for example, you could you could show something really horrible, but then have this really happy music playing, and just the contrast of those two just makes it even more horrid, you know.
Mm-hmm. It's like that same exact thing. Yeah. I like that a lot.
Yeah, that's what I feel. It's a really, really powerful cinematography where the director is so bold to show really, really strong images in terms of aesthetic and subject matter, and then confront them with the music or a score that takes them into a totally different level.
Yeah.
Like Kubrick was doing that. Just crazy. God. How strong it hits. For example, Ghost in the Shell as well. Like the original chants that are played during the movie, whereas the movie is really sci-fi and it's set in the future, but the music is really traditional folklore stuff, and it really takes it into this really weird spot when the sci-fi anime starts to be like psychological thing. So it's just awesome to experience that.
Yeah, and like Akira in the first, yeah. Like, you know, like that first song when they're in that when they're fighting the clown gang. That's like the coolest song ever, and it's so the opposite of the future. It's like, you know, they have that crazy drum going on. That's like, I forget what it's called, but
yeah,
it's super cool.
Taiko drums, I think. No. They're like traditional Japanese drums.
You know, we have seen that recently with the Guardians of the Galaxy as well, right? Mm. Not a regular kind of soundtrack, but 80s, right? The sounds from the 80s and like a little bit different direction again, but still, the trend is somewhat there, taking a sci-fi.
But it's like the feeling of sci-fi almost. Like it's like, it reminds me of, like it's not just a, like what I thought was really cool about that choice was that it's not just that it's different, it's that it's like from a time when sci-fi was huge. Like that kind of specific sci-fi was really popular was when that kind of music was around, like The Last Starfighter and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, this is really cool. It evokes so much more than just the nostalgia from, like, you know, seeing that kind of like colorful space opera thing. It's also the whole era combined into there. It's like really, really cool.
Yeah, there's like a meta level of retro in there that's really nicely blended in.
Hmm.
Yeah, somebody's in the chat mentioning Quentin Tarantino. Yeah, that's the guy that can take music in his movies into a totally different level, to the point it's actually remembered for a long, long time.
Yeah, just like the whistle. That's in that Everything's a Remix one, too.
Yeah.
All right, so I have another question. Who's your art mentor, the artist that inspires you the most?
I already talked about him, but my most, like, if I were to say, like, direct mentor, it's like, every single conversation I've ever had with Marko Durjevic, he's like the most inspirational dude. Oh my god. Like that dude like floors me. Like I've never seen anybody, like before I visited him, I'd never seen anybody work that hard. And it was like I had never really thought you could like do that. I don't know, it's hard to explain. Like it's like just this Degenesis book that came out. Like, I remember seeing that when he was in the middle of it and being like, wow, like, you're just doing this? Like, you're doing all the client work with the studio and then this, like, 700-page book? Like, what the hell? How do you manage all this? And then, like, on top of that, he's, you know, he's, like, waiting to get, like, surgery done, and he's like, I'm not going to get surgery until I'm done with the book. Like, Jesus Christ. Wow. And I was just, like, so blown away by, like, his passion and drive for it. So anytime I ever need advice or an opinion on something, I always contact him first, and I'm like, what do you think I should do with this or project or, like, you know, anything, really. And he always gives me the best advice, so.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome. I'm just posting the link to the Facebook page of the Genesis project if you want to check it out. Looks great.
It's beautiful. Just
yeah, I'm looking
everything
at
it right in now. It. Ugh.
Yeah, check it out, guys.
What are the other things you love in your life besides art?
I like I don't know, I tend to take things that aren't related to art and make them related to art, because mm-hmm. otherwise I won't be myself in what I'm doing. So, like, you know, I'll turn jokes with that me and my friend Dan, like, tell each other whatever, into, like, the Steve Lichtman comic. So, like, that's just me and Dan talking on Skype, and we just go back and forth on lines until we find enough stuff that we think is funny, and then we just go off from there, and we're like, okay, so what does Dracula say here? You know, like, what happens here? And then we just, like, keep going on and on improvising. So I try to turn everything I love outside of art into art so that it becomes, you know, so that my job is, like, exactly what I love doing in every aspect of my life.
Uh-huh.
But, yeah, I mean, outside of, like, that, I'll skateboard and I'll, you know, I like writing a lot. I do that probably, like, more than anything else.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, I don't know. I mean, hiking, traveling, any sort of nature stuff. Like, I'm huge into, like, going out into the mountains and just exploring, seeing animals. Like, you know, there's nothing better than, like, a all-day hike and being done with it and going to sleep in a tent.
Yeah,
just feel,
yeah.
like, so relieved.
Yeah. It's amazing.
All right, cool.
We'll be hiking soon with some level up people as well, hopefully.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that thing seems so cool. I was, like, super excited when I saw that. I was like, that's exactly the fucking thing that I wanted to do with, like, Crimson Daggers. But I was like, I don't know how to do this. And
oh, we don't know how to do this.
Well, I know. I don't think anybody knows how to do anything that takes yeah. time like yeah. that. That's pretty ambitious.
Yeah, that's why they have disclaimers, you know.
Yeah, but in this case, we'll improvise to the point at work.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, you know...
The first eight people will be the guinea pigs.
Yeah, I think it will be a great experience. So what we are talking about here, for those who doesn't know, this is an initiative that we thought that we basically created with guys here. It's called Level Up Quest. So it's a 9-day art trip that is going to be placed in one of the countries that the people that are signing in will choose, basically. Unfortunately, it's not... you have to pay up your costs, basically. The only costs... there are no other costs. It's free, but you have to cover your own expenses during the way. So that's how we want to stay true to the Level Up...
spirit.
Spirit, yeah, exactly. So if you want to check it out, what it's about, go to the Frustrada page, and there's a huge banner, intimidating huge banner.
Yeah, you can't miss it.
You cannot miss that shit. Yeah, Jonas took some time to actually make it unseenable, basically.
Yeah, and there's a pixel art of Wojtek in his underpants throwing a French baguette. So you have to check out that stuff if you haven't seen it.
Yeah, so basically there will be a form that you can sign up for it, and we will unfortunately choose people to go with us, but once you sign up, we will you will be added to the...
yeah, to the queue, basically, so you'll have, you know, you'll be picked ahead of people who sign up later if there's a next quest, so...
Yeah.
Are you guys screening serial killers?
We'd try to, as far as you can screen serial killers through a Google Hangout call. I mean, the clever ones, they don't show it usually. They're usually very nice.
I know.
When you talk to them, so we'll see.
Yeah, we were been talking about it. Actually, it will only make it more fun.
Yeah, exactly. A little bit of drama in there.
You'll be at the top of a mountain fighting a serial killer.
Yeah, man. Some good reference right there.
Yeah, people popping out their sketchbooks.
Yeah. Sketch the moments. Get that action in there.
Yeah. So as you can see, we are trying to bring you a lot of different experiences through this platform, through Level Up. So our website is a little bit... you know, we keep adding things, and I think it will hold not so many more. So we are trying to bring you a new thing. So just saying.
Yeah, a lot of new features, maybe some new content.
And Darek's been spending a lot of time designing beautiful underpants, Level Up themed underwear.
Well, yeah, man, what's that about? I didn't have a chance to ask you. What the hell?
Yeah, I thought we could maybe just attach it as a contest prize in the new upcoming one. I don't know if it's the right time to show it. I don't know.
Maybe not
sure. I don't know. We should ask Dave.
Yeah, maybe not interrupt him. Maybe in the end of the session.
Okay, yeah. I have a.
because you know that we know that Dave is a specialist in making a T-shirt, so if he sees ours, it's really like, what the fuck. I want to avoid it. So
Dave, can you talk a little bit about the shading process you're using right now?
This is just one color on a multiply layer that I'm doing that's attached to all the other layers here. So I made like the one base layer. And then I attach a layer to that and just work in each section. So, like, the eyes and the skin and then the hair and everything else. But I do a color balance to just kind of unify everything. Mm-hmm. And then I use a multiply layer, and I selected the green here from the kerchief he's wearing.
Yeah, and that actually the last... part that you are doing right now is just amazing, because it shows the form itself, you know, very subtle, the light, how the light, you know, works within the shadow, with the shadow, in relationship to the shadow. So it's awesome to see.
Thanks. Yeah, I want it to be the secondary light, you know, in the shadow there, and I want it to work with the overall color scheme. So I'll usually use if there were like a background of a sky or something, then that would be the multiply color.
Yeah, so basically you're using one color, usually strong color, and then you will do the entire shadow pass with that color.
Yep.
Yeah, that's very cool.
I'm trying to keep it as simple as possible.
Yeah. And there's people just saying in the chat, you makes it looks so easy.
Yeah, it's not.
Don't be fooled.
Don't be fooled. Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is, like, just coming to this style, like, over time, has been so much harder for me than doing paintings. Like, I mean, just because it's not what I do. Like, it's not what I used to do. So, like, it was such a learning process. It's crazy.
But it's you know, I want to be fair, but it's much more unique if you look, you know, and on the both side of both styles that you were doing, right? The rendering style is awesome in terms of, you know, the technique and using the light and the details. But this is something that very unique that you can create, you know, with your soul, you know, very subtle and very dynamic. So it's much more different, and I think it's awesome. So,
thanks. But that's it's different in the community that we're in. So, like,
this is
so common. Like, this is, you know, I had read online, what did I read? Something about, when I put out my tutorial, somebody said, like, oh, great, now anybody who uses line art is going to be accused of ripping off Rapoza. And I'm like, dude, like, every single person at Marvel Comics works like this. Like, everybody who does, you know, like, this basic, simple thing, you know, uses a similar approach. This is by no means something I came up with. I'm just trying to figure it out, like, for myself.
Yeah, but still much more rare on the, you know, on the illustrations, you know, and you can see illustration around, like, on Facebook or other sites. So
yeah,
we are doing a lot of rendering style pictures with matte paints and all that shit. So
Yeah, there are different circles, I think.
Yeah.
Different kind of circles.
But I think, like, if you have an opportunity to be the only person doing, or one of the only people doing one kind of style in a group that's, you know, predominantly one thing or the other, it helps you stand out so much more, especially if you're a freelancer and you're focused on marketing yourself.
So pick your audience. Pick them wisely.
It's why, like, a really, like, if any painter right now went and did, like, if you went into Marvel Comics right now and you started doing that rendering style but for pages, and, you know, you'd have to obviously get good at visual storytelling and being able to do that, you know, on a page. But if you did get good at that, you would be in such high demand, it'd be crazy.
Yeah.
But there's just nobody doing it. So there's so many places out there that you could be. It would be very beneficial for your career if you wanted that.
So there's another question. A flagship question we tend to ask every guest.
Here we go.
Would you rather be a Godzilla or a billionaire, and why?
Godzilla. Because nobody really wants to be a billionaire. They want to do what they think that being a billionaire does. It's like, but Godzilla, he can do whatever the fuck he wants.
I don't know. I don't think he can use chopsticks.
Who needs to use chopsticks? I mean, he could use chopsticks. He could just get two big trees. You got to get creative. That's why we're in this field.
Ah, so that's why you're picking him. Okay.
Yeah, you can use chopsticks. Definitely. All right, so we've got covered. Awesome. All right, so a little bit different question. Do you have an art goal in mind? What do you want to be doing in 10 years or something like this?
What do I think I'll be doing in 10 years?
Do you have, like, a specific art goal in mind? Like, a plan? Yeah, like, besides projects you do?
No, I have no idea. I don't know what I'm doing now. Like, I don't have a goal. I have goals in short term, but, like, I don't know where I want to end up. Like, I get bored so easy that I can't, like, put a pen in it. I don't know, like, what's going to come up. Because I might end up doing, you know, like, if I really want to go crazy, I just might do, like, traditional animation for, like, a couple years and just become a...
Yeah, and that's what makes it more exciting, right? Not to know everything, maybe just coming with it along the way. Yeah,
I want to keep it totally open, but I would like to be in a position where I'm comfortable doing, like, let's say, like, for that same thing, like, I'm comfortable doing something like animation. I'd like to just be in a space like that. That would be really cool, to have a grasp on that. That kind of profession.
That's awesome. It's a pain in the ass, I can tell you. I did animation for 5 years. I mean, I loved it, and it's one of the best lessons in discipline and learning to work hard that you can get. And get like a, I have like this tumor knob on my middle finger, which is from holding a pencil and doing like 12,000 frames. But yeah, it's a very interesting experience. I'm really sad that it's kind of disappearing. 2D animation. I've loved it my whole life, and yeah.
I think it's like up to a new group to bring it back though. Like I don't like to me if I to me everybody's waiting for another kind of like, and I don't mean quality wise. I just mean that they're waiting for something like an Akira again. Like the trend is there. Like people want that, but nobody's providing it. If somebody just had the capital to like invest in that into a studio to make that happen again, it would be huge.
It's hard because times have changed, and I feel like those kind of things are very much a product of their time and that they were just in the right time. And I think it would be hard these days. I mean, there's new possibilities, obviously, and something different might come along. But
what else can you actually build it from than people that love this? I mean, it's possible as long as you have people that want to see it and want to create it. So yeah, as long as you have these two ingredients, of course, money, right? But if you have people that want to see it, then you have kind of a capital, right? Nowadays, it's possible, right, with crowdfunding and stuff.
Yeah, it's definitely possible, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's my hope. I would love to see that again because it's, you know, it's not like it's, there's, you know, not an obvious need. It's like you go on Tumblr or something, and it's everywhere. Like, everybody reposts these old animation things. They're like, wow, this is really crazy. And it's not just, like, nostalgia. Like, I would still watch that stuff if it weren't for, like, you know, I'm in the middle of watching one of those animations, and then some big CG robot comes out, and I'm like, what the fuck is that? Like, it's just, like, insane. Like, you're asking me not to notice it. It's like, yeah, if I were watching, you know, Saving Private Ryan, and then, like, all of a sudden a guy in a big blue suit walked out and was like, let's get him. And I'm like, I see you. You're not real. Like, like, you think you blend in? Like, what the hell are you doing? Like, that's what the CG stuff is to me in, like, the traditional animation spots. Like, I get that it's supposed to be, like, more cost-effective and everything, but it just kills it for me.
I think Studio 4 Degrees does a really good job with that, actually. Have you seen... you seen any of their movies?
Maybe, but I don't know it off the studio name.
Oh, man. Oof, a whole world's going to open for you. They did a Mind Game, Tech on Kinkreet, a bunch of
I've seen
short
that.
Films. They recently did three films about Berserk. Do you know, like, Berserk comic book? So,
yeah, I did. I saw that one. I didn't like the animation in that much.
No?
I mean, not like the CG parts. I thought they were obvious.
Yeah, I mean, it's a modern style. It's a very clean kind of style, but I feel like that they're very good at staying true to something that belongs with the film or the theme or the nature of the film. And I think that the style that they used fits very well with the Berserk world. I mean, if you look at something like Mind Game, that's completely different. It's the same people who did it, you know. It's like really psychedelic and sort of, you know, drawn in a sort of naive way, you know, not realistic, and weird perspectives and weird camera angles and stuff. It's, I don't know, I just feel like they always pull it off really nicely, whatever they do.
Yeah, I'll definitely check that out. That sounds cool. It's called Mind Game.
Yeah, I think you will love it. It's very crazy. Yeah, right, and very colorful, and, you know, like, yeah. But I think you will love it. Yeah, it's really, really cool.
Yeah, I still go back and watch, like, a lot of the old anime stuff just to get, like, a better idea of things. I do, like, I've been trying to just, like, I'll take old, there's this one really amazing Gundam short that, it was a pitch for a new show, but it didn't really go anywhere. And, what the hell is it called? It has, like, the animation style is so beautiful. It's in, like, 1080p on YouTube. I think it's, like, F something. It's Gundam F whatever pilot. It's gorgeous, but I've been taking gifts from that I find on Tumblr and trying to, like, replicate them and doing, like, my own animation.
Oh, yeah, cool.
To study it. It's so cool. It has that feel, like that old retro feel, but it's like so, it's like the cleanest retro feel. It's amazing, like that 70s style Gundam animation.
Yeah. So now you're drawing a second character, or?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. You've done like five characters in less than an hour and a half.
Like a boss.
Yeah.
But I found that, like, the animation stuff has made me super fast with lines, at least compared to where I was. It's so beneficial, it's crazy.
Yeah, it forces you to be more loose and spontaneous, right?
Well, yeah, and also to focus on the things that really matter in your designs, like, because so much of your time, sometimes you'll just, like, go into too much detail, and it's not as effective as it could be. And, you know, like, you have to focus on big, readable shapes. And I was talking to somebody who was starting a comic book, and all of the characters are kind of similar, And I was like, well, you know, there's going to be a lot of fights in this book. There's going to be all this stuff. It's like, you should really study, like, animators because, you know, you're supposed to be able to pick these guys out of a crowd.
Yeah.
But if everybody looks the same, it's just not going to read. Like, if you have a big group shot and everybody has the same jacket on, everybody has the same design, they're just going to blend in and you're not going to be able to tell the difference. It becomes, like, so important to differentiate and have these big shapes that read automatically. It's such a good help.
Yeah, give them bright hair colors. Pink, purple, orange.
Yeah. Varying dick sizes.
Yeah, that's very noticeable.
Yeah, it's the first thing I look at. When I'm fighting a guy, I'm like, how big is his dick? Then I beat the shit out of him.
So let's have a look in the chat. Have you guys gone through all the questions of the of Facebook?
Not through all.
Okay. The one with the least votes is someone asking Wojtek to paint his portrait.
Fans. Wojtek, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Okay, cool.
Are you going to paint the portrait for the guy?
Yeah, for sure, man. I'm just doing that.
Oh, you were already doing it. Okay, cool.
Not really. Alright, you're not being rude. What's the most exciting project you have ever worked on, Dave?
I used to think it was like the stuff that were the bigger name things, like being able to work on like different movies and stuff. But I don't know. I don't like that anymore. I was like, it becomes more about like what the job is rather than like it being like a high profile thing. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, what am I actually doing? But the jobs that I have now, I can't talk about them. I can't go into detail about like who it is and whatever, but I've gotten a lot of jobs doing basically like entirely my style for everything, and they just let me do whatever I want for like new video games. And it's the craziest shit ever. Like, I didn't even know the job existed. Like, I knew concept art existed, but they've just said, just for like weeks now, just like, do anything you want. Do anything you want. We're just going to pay you for it. And I'm like, this is the greatest experience I've ever had working. Yeah. This is the best job. And then it was like, you know, we're going to give you a week, come up with concepts, and then I did that, and they were like, okay, let's expand this to 2 more weeks. And they're like, okay, let's expand this to 8 more weeks. And I was like, this is so fucking awesome. And this has been, like, the best experience. I don't know when the game's coming out or, you know, what's going on with it, but this is my, like, job that I have right now. It's super exciting. I've just been drawing anything and everything and stupid shit and whatever. It's so much fun.
Yeah, I think people are even more stoked to become concept artists now.
It definitely isn't like that all the time for me.
Oh my god, I'm just looking at the t-shirt designs that Tarek did. Oh my god. Yeah, this will be a good outro for the episode today.
Have you seen that, the cooking
Man.
Time?
Yeah, I saw the cooking time, you idiots. But there's one where you kind of, your face, you kind of look like, I don't know, like Al Pacino or something.
Which one?
The Come to Papa one.
Who looks like Al Pacino?
Okay.
No, I don't know. He just, Darek looks like just some sexy Italian pimp or something. I don't know.
Are the pimps the sexy ones?
This one is. And then you only made one t-shirt for girls, and that's the horny boar one. For the guys who don't know the horny boar, watch episode... Is it 2 or 3? It's one of the first.
Black coloring, black and white pictures.
Yeah,
that's
so I think
I remember.
the third level up session ever, where Darek was a little bit delirious for some reason, and he was painting a horny pig. So, yeah, check it out if you want to see it. Or buy the t-shirt.
Alright, maybe we can show it right now.
Oh god, Darek, man. That's so inappropriate, but okay.
Alright, so...
Can I see the horny pig?
Yeah, of course, it's the first one that I did, so... Can you see my screen right now?
Yeah, I'm looking at it. Let me see this.
So this is the first t-shirt.
you did like 20 designs. You're crazy, man.
It's just funny, man.
It's one of the basic one, so we are going hard.
Zoom in on the horny pig, please.
Zoom in on that one.
Yeah.
It's typical, and I want to also mention the guy who yesterday posted the tattooed hand with our logo. Man, it's just insane, and we were, you know, so happy to see it, and we just, I don't have any words for it, but it's, like, amazing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's level up t-shirt.
Can you zoom in on the horny board, please? Go back.
Yeah, sure. I think that it's, it's kind of pixely, but, you know.
Yeah, it's definitely good placement in terms of zooming in, I would say.
We can leave it for later. Alright, go farther, because it's like the time is going, so...
Okay.
It's from our typical quotes from level up sessions.
Your quotes, man! You have like 30 quotes on your name. Me and Wojtek have like one or two.
Yeah.
Our favorite.
Man, I can tell you took some time to think out about the typo and like placement and shit. You took some time with it.
Yeah, I also maybe That's we irony. Could do. We were thinking about collaboration, three of us, and doing some Godzilla Billionaire or something like this. So maybe. All right, so going forward.
No.
There's not a single human in the world that's gonna wear that. Vodka bottled Chippendale only applying a spray tan to his body.
Here you are.
Oh, nice.
Oh, god damn it.
Why are we standing on like a stone inside a pool?
I don't remember.
Yeah, that's the sexy one. You look like some Sicilian mafiosi here.
God damn, it's so terrible, man. So terrible.
Who's that ugly bearded baby? Oh my god. What the? Where did you get such a... And, dude, what's up with my hand? I mean, that looks like something naughty going on outside. That's I don't like
that's
that.
That's why you are smiling, you know? That's why you're so smiling.
Yeah, I think it's Polish sausage.
That smug face, it's horrible.
All right, and the last one that we probably will tell to Dave.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, that's from the session with Maciej, right?
Yeah, and one of our, you know, last words.
Yeah, last words to Maciej. Yeah, let's pray for him. Yeah, that's a perfect quote. Yeah.
Yeah, so right. The people who are watching, pick your favorite t-shirt and we might actually consider
include it somewhere.
Making it available.
Please, no. Yeah.
Dude, I mean, if some girl wants to wear Come to Papa, then who are you to tell
her? Okay, I'm backing off, sorry. Sorry.
Don't listen to Wojtek, don't listen to Wojtek. Alright, going back to Dave, stop it.
I'm surprised there was no horse t-shirt. Is that the secret one, or...?
Not yet, probably.
Okay.
Darek is going to cook it during the week.
Okay.
Yeah, man.
That was terrible. Thank you.
Hey, you gotta stop merchandising, man. Oh, it's God. Better. It's better if you expose yourself entirely on the shirts.
Yeah.
Just muscly. Muscly, which is
yeah, guys. It's a good promotional trick. So.
Yeah. Yeah, and then people meet you in real life, and they're really, really disappointed.
I'm working it. people like Come to Papa, so it's cool.
I like Come to Papa. I think it's a nice design for underwear. Yeah. I would totally let someone else wear it.
Cool, man.
Well, that's good. You're so generous, man.
I know.
3 Come to Papa XXL, please.
I want the muscular Wojtek, someone says.
You can find him in Paris. You can find him in Paris. His address is...
I cannot even pronounce my address, man.
Is it Rue de Polski?
Bol de Voix?
What? Don't even try, man.
Darek trying to speak French. That's going to go on a t-shirt next year, I'm sure.
Yeah, man, you should pick up some French girls on your French, you know? It'd be awesome.
Yeah, they will think you're very cute.
Actually, I just acted at one of my first dates with Marta, and I took her hand and I started, you know, telling broken French.
Really?
that I really didn't understand.
Really?
And you were a couple for like 4 years now.
She somehow liked it. I don't know. It was so fucked up.
You're one of those puppy people that you just can't be mad at, you know? Like, you can just not be mad at Darek. It's impossible. Nothing he does is with, you know, malicious intentions. And if he does something malicious, it's completely unintentional. Like, when he was staying at my place, sorry that I'm telling this story, but he was like, he woke up in the morning and he's like in my living room in his underpants and my flatmates, his French girls, who have never seen him before. Like, hello, good. And he's like, hey, good morning. Like, trying to...
Like, you have even the photos, right?
You do, but not
don't show it, man.
No, you do not accept a handshake from a man who's in his underwear. That's just like a general rule, because you just feel like he's been itchy 5 minutes before that and you just don't want to touch his hand.
Oh my god. Good times.
Yeah, but yeah.
Yeah, enough. Yeah, coming back to the liner.
In the meantime, they just did some another awesome character. So
yeah, and I was about to ask, where do you get ideas for your characters? I mean, besides Starville and all the characters you already came up with, what's your main inspiration, and where do you get the personalities from?
I don't know. I mean, the personality stuff, I mean, like, I think, like, that side of it's just things I like, or, like, I don't know, faces I make. But as far as, like, the designs and things, it's just books. Like, I have lots of old books and things I look at, and, like, designs of, like, clothing and whatever, stuff I think is interesting that I'll look at when I'm taking a shit, which is literally, like, all it is. I sit there on the toilet and look at them.
That's like, a perfect time for a notebook. Yeah.
I have like a bunch of them. I have like a bunch of like old weapon books and stuff like that. And I also look at a lot of other artists. I have like Kim Jong Gi's book that I look at also while I'm on the toilet. And that dude, I forget his, what the hell is his name? The guy who did the, Tactics Ogre, Let Us Cling Together art book. It's like one of my favorite art books ever. The designs in there are like just amazing. It kills me. Look at that all the time too for inspiration. But then I'm just kind of pulling from like a vague library in my head. Stuff that I like to look at.
The book is called Tactics Ogre Artworks, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've never seen this. That's very cool.
It's really good. If you're looking on Google, there's like a bunch of examples in the book.
Can't seem to find the name of the artists. Well, it's in Japanese, so. Yeah, it's cool stuff. I'll post a link in the group if people want to check it out.
Yeah. So, Dave, do you have your nemesis in terms of drawing, like the thing you just avoided? Like, knowing you, you probably avoided it for like 2 days and then you started practicing exactly this. So my question is, do you have something you fear of drawing? Or you worked hard enough to not have these things now?
I don't know. I guess, like, I wouldn't avoid it, but there are things I'm definitely not good at. Like, I can't draw. I mean, I will be able to, but right now I can't draw, like, massive city scenes the way, like, Marvel artists do, which I think is amazing whenever I see it. I'm like, how do you do line art of an entire city? That makes me want to die. Like, I don't understand it. It's so crazy. So much. But, yeah, that kind of stuff. Drawing cars is really hard for me. I can do it, but I have to have reference. I can't just pull it from my head. I can draw Kawasaki Ninja motorcycles from my head. That's because I have a model, like, over on my shelf, and I used to practice drawing that all the time at all different angles for Skull and Shark, so that, because that book has a lot of that motorcycle in it. 1987.
Yeah, so it basically just comes down with practicing certain shapes. You know, you feel comfortable doing characters because you've drawn thousands of characters in your life.
Right.
Some people always draw cars, they're very good at it, and you ask them to draw a character and they find it incredibly difficult. So.
Yeah,
I mean, there's loads of stuff like that that I've had to get over and have learned a lot from. So, you know, it's just a matter of doing it. I'll get to it eventually. It's just that the book I'm working on now has just so much, like, organic shapes, and a lot of the machinery is organic. And it's more of the kind of character angle. And I'm more focused on learning how to do, like, comic storytelling, which was my huge weak point. I took a comics class once when I was younger. Like, it was the only thing I ever went to, like, a college campus for. Like, they had this guy who's a Marvel artist, and he had a comics course about, like, storytelling. And me and my friend Dan took it, and that was pretty helpful. I still use a lot of that information. But outside of that, I didn't really know much, so I've been trying to figure it out.
Mm-hmm. So I see also people asking about your previous project, School and the Shark. How it's going? It's like you stopped with it, or you are planning to develop it more in the future?
Well, I had done a lot on the project, and it just got to the point where I was like, I'm rendering all this, and if I don't understand storytelling well enough, it's just going to be useless work. It's like I'm going into this huge project without, you know, and doing this like high caliber finish on every page. Like, I'm making sure everything's rendered and pretty looking or whatever. And then in the meantime, it's like I'm letting all the really important fundamental stuff just fall by the wayside. Like, it's not important, you know, like I shouldn't have a focus on it. And it was really hurting the project. So I ended up throwing away like 20 pages and, just decided that I would use Starveil as a way of learning how to do all that.
Okay.
And
yeah,
so
but
it looks
very nice, the shark, and just going the shark. Just did also animations and some more you know, advanced pictures, right?
Yeah.
Some, yeah.
But yeah, it's a lot of work. Like when you it's the whole thing. I actually posted like a really long thing about it on my blog the other day about shortcuts. But it's one of the big things I learned from that, where I was coming off of having done like a bunch of just, you know, finished pictures that were just finished, and I had put them out there, and I was like, okay, I just have to do this before a comic. And then you realize when you start doing a comic how much planning is involved in the whole process, and you're like, shit, if I have to do all of this planning, like, I really ought to figure out everything else before I just dive into it. Because I'm going to have to go back and change all of this if I really don't know what I'm doing. So, yeah, it was this big realization of, like, how often and in everything I do that I just kind of would wing it without really understanding anything, and how little planning I had actually put into doing my own personal work, and like how everything struggled. I mean, everything kind of like was hurt by that. Like, I would go in trying to just finish images so that I could post them up online without actually having an idea, and creating all this forgettable content that really was, you know, at the end of the day, it's just another picture that you're looking at of a monster freaking out. So, yeah, like having to draw characters for Starvale and whatever, planning out, like, you know, a personality, having, like, there be certain aspects of the design that stand out that are a little different, or, you know, just having a little extra thought in there, all came from having to plan out a comic book and feeling like, oh, man, I really don't know what I'm doing, and I'm kind of cheapening this whole process for myself when I do this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you learned a lot, right? In the same time when you just even when you stopped it, it's like a huge step for, you know, for doing the IP like Star Release, right?
Yeah, like it just ended up like opening my eyes to a lot of things. I learned so much, and now, like, I mean I'm super happy that I made that decision. So, like, I'm glad that I didn't know how to do any of those things. And then I got to see that. Got to hate myself for it.
Well, it's just a part of the learning experience, I guess, because, you know, you wouldn't be where you are if you didn't make those mistakes. You'd be doing different stuff.
Is it the same with unfinished illustrations or concepts? It's like you spend on it some time, you learned, and even if you put it aside, it's still, you know, some part of the progressing, right?
Yeah, you have to be able to let go. Just get rid of something, tear your picture to pieces.
Yeah, I think it helps to, like, really, like, not just do it and have it, you know, be whatever, but to actually, like, analyze it and be like, why wasn't this that great? Like, why don't people like this that much? Like, why don't I like this that much? Like, was it truly fun for me in the process? And why does a job have to be a job? Like, why can't I enjoy the whole thing? What's stopping me from feeling that way? And then, like, trying to break that down and go back into your work and be like, okay, I'm going to try and enjoy this any way I can. So, like, maybe there's a new style I can bring to the table, or some interesting ideas I can bring that are mine that they're not even asking for. You know, like having a little bit more confidence in, like, what I suggest and everything else. I've learned a lot just, like, kind of looking over past work and not just being like, oh, that wasn't that great and on to the next thing, but, like, truly, why wasn't that great? Also, don't watch porn ever. That's the worst thing you can do. Being a freelancer.
Someone in the chat is saying that your character needs a dentist. Bitch needs a dentist.
Yeah, bitch does need a dentist.
Smart boy.
I don't think a dentist would fix that. I think something like, I don't know.
An axe to the face would fix that.
That's what I think.
Yeah, it's very cool stuff, Dave. It's amazing to see how you can just knock out these amazing line drawings.
Like, you can just tell how used to it you are, how much knowledge you have about the entire process.
Thanks. I have a lot of fun doing this kind of thing. That was the main part about it, was as I actually found out I really didn't have that much fun doing all the rendering.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's nice to have something look finished, but when there was, like, not that much enjoyment, like, I was more just doing it to do it. But this is all enjoyment the whole way through. It's like the process flows enough for me that it's more about creating something that's like cool or like something that's fun.
But you had to get to that point to come to that realization, right? Because otherwise, how would you know? It's just how you develop as a person as you age and as you become more professional or more successful. You also get to do more what you want, and you know, you don't have to worry about expectations as much once you're a little bit settled. You know?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely nice to have some sort of, you know, place in the industry for yourself where you're like, I know I can get work and it's okay to take a risk to do something like this. And I mean, and not that I think it's a risk really, but it's more like comfortable because I know I can do other things too, like if I had to.
Yeah, it's kind of like you have to work hard to earn that, you know, luxury in a way.
Yeah. Yeah, and you have to fail on like every level all the time in order to just like keep discovering those things. Like, it'd be so easy. Like, that I kind of got really mad at myself because I was like, it's too easy to just sit here and do the same shit that I've been doing forever. Like, it's so simple to just be like, oh, if I put this on Facebook, everybody's gonna like it. It's like, I got so tired of that. Like, it felt gross.
Yeah, I guess your priorities just shift as well because you learn from those experiences.
Yeah, you have to, like, really, after a while, like, once you're kind of in it for a long time, feeling like, oh, why do I do this? Like, you have those moments.
It's a weird human thing, like, where you get confronted more with your, you know, biology than with what you're doing exactly.
Yeah, that's the best part about, like, I think getting into a place where it's, like, you're kind of used to that, like, response or something from your, like, people who like your work or whatever, and you're like, oh, do I really like why am I such a asshole where I put work out because I want people to like it? Like, I don't want to do that anymore. I want to do what I do because I'm getting better at it, and like I'm moving towards something. I want to always be moving towards something instead of just sitting in the attention and letting it like wash over me.
Yeah, but like, again,
I
think that's just, a natural part of the process that everyone goes through, you know. I mean, people who are watching you right now, what they see you do right now, to them it's absolutely mind-blowing. And I'm not going to say you take it for granted, but for you, you know, you're used to it because it's a part of your everyday life and you've seen it for such a long time. But people who see it, they're just like, yeah, I want to be able to do that, you know. And this whole attention thing is the same principle. It's basically something that is, you know, natural to the process of becoming an artist, is, you know, how other people perceive your art, and only after you achieve that can you understand that and actually let go of it as well.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's, you have to get past like the ego trip of being like, you know, like everybody says, I mean, like a lot of people will say like, you know, I don't really have an ego, like I hate myself, but we all put our stuff out there because we're like, look at it, please. I finished this, look at it.
Yeah.
It's like you wouldn't put it online, you wouldn't give a shit. It's like, we all have that in us, but it's like you gotta, when you feel yourself getting too content, or like, you know, you don't feel like you feel like you're doing it more because of a group than anything else, like you're doing it because you need to be a part of something, or you need a certain response, it's like, gotta reevaluate everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that's natural. I hope people get that way, but I think that some people never move away from that. Not that I'm like this awesome dude, but it's too bad if you end up getting sucked into the trap of appealing to everybody all the time, mm-hmm. because you feel pressure from a group to not fail in front of all of them. Like, that's a mm-hmm. scary thing.
Yeah, definitely.
Looking for some
in the silence.
Yeah, I was looking through the chat to see if there are more questions, but people are just saying funny things about farts and yeah. Yeah, we're already 2 hours in actually.
Yeah.
Went really? Fast. Yeah, it went quite fast.
Good times always fly fast, so.
Yep.
Yeah, it's cool being on here with you guys. This is a pretty relaxed atmosphere.
Yeah, it's very relaxed sometimes.
Yeah, it's too relaxed.
Sometimes it's too much.
Yeah. Sometimes people are like, where is our guest? Like, you forget about guests, you're talking about stupid t-shirts. Yeah. We are sorry for that. You know, we are still, you know... We are not
ourselves, right?
It's a hangout, you know. It's a hangout at the end of the day that you're just like as a weird creep kind of perving, listening in on us, chilling out.
Yeah.
It's funny because when, you know, I think some people when they come on a level up session, they're a little bit nervous. I mean, I think I was a bit nervous at the first one. But we're so used to doing it that sometimes there's this stark contrast between the guest who's like kind of nervous and, you know, feels the pressure to make sure that there's always been something said. And we're just like chilling. Just like back, scratching our heads.
Yeah, I think I'm like the least nervous person.
That's true, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't
also,
care.
You have live streamed a lot, so that may be
Yeah, you're used to it.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't care. That's the second thing. Like, you're doing such a great job that I don't think you should be worried about anything. Just awesome, awesome stuff. Yeah, guys, so if you are enjoying what you see with Level Up, please subscribe to our channel. If you have no idea what is it about, go to the fusro.com page or just type in Level Up live stream on Google, you will find it.
Yeah, and that just don't forget to save that amazing pieces because we had a session, I think it was with Miles, and he had some things in Photoshop and he lost everything.
For
2 hours.
Oh, yeah, I haven't saved this yet.
So, yeah, if you are, you know, if you are cool with it, you just can. It would be awesome if you put it on your, you know, Facebook page or so, and also in the event page of today's event. So, yeah,
sure.
Because it's beautiful. So, yeah, feel free to do it. Man.
And feel free to check out the new Hangout option that we included in the website. That's also really excites us that it actually works. It's really awesome. So if you want to hang out with like-minded people or just, you know, get a quick critique or see what everybody's up to, go to our website and choose a room, a Godzilla room or a billionaire room, and see what happens.
Yeah, we are hanging there from time to time if there is any empty slot, so probably we'll see you guys again soon.
Yep.
So feel free to join there and have fun and level up.
I like how you snuck that in. Branding.
Year of practice.
Yeah, how is this going, by the way? I mean, like, I like the casualness because then you don't have to, like, it doesn't feel as much like a job or anything. You can keep it up really easily, hopefully. But, like, how has it been going with, like, the crowd and everything?
Really good, I would say. Because there's no pressure on our end, we don't have that much pressure to perform. It's on a very human level, and I think people seem to appreciate that. Like, sometimes it surprises me how people, you know, they talk to us and they're like, huge fan, and I think, like, oh, but we're, we're kind of slackers in many ways as well, you know, because we're not being paid for this, so we have no reason to you know, not because we slack with a lot of stuff, you know, we forget to update the website or we forget to, you know, do this. We always turn it into a joke because that's really
and we always tell something. We always tell, you know, very often phrase, it's going to be posted soon or updated soon or done soon.
But
we'll inform you soon. Stay tuned.
Stay tuned forever.
Yeah, exactly. But it becomes this kind of running joke, and people already know it. That's kind of what they're getting. And usually we come around at some point. No, but I think the human aspect and the slight clumsiness sometimes is actually charming for some people. At least I hope so.
It's humanizing.
I hope so as well, because we just, you know, just to be fair, we are trying to stay. We don't even try. We are just staying ourselves. So
yeah.
So don't fake anything. As you can see, some of the stories are already revealed.
Sorry, man.
No problem. And we don't bother. So yeah, we are happy to have you all, people. And what is very appealing that the group is still living and is living better from week to week, right?
Yeah.
And people are commenting, helping each other. So basically level up, as we said at the beginning, is just going its own life, right? Mm-hmm. People are just, it's like a traffic, it's like a small city, so let it be there that way. And we don't want to change anything, you know, on some more, like, you know, not suitable way for you. So we will stay the same, and hopefully we will last as much as we can.
Yeah, and for now we will try to keep things condensed a little bit more. So basically we have a lot of different things going, different events, like quests or hangouts or resources page or watch sessions page and stuff like a lot of, you know, events that has to be conformed into something more, I don't know, easier to, yeah, organized, I think. So I think for now we will stop doing new things. We will just keep improving what we have to provide you with even better
quality and
experiences.
And the same thing that we just told you at the beginning about the questions, I think that we think that we will include the questions before every session in the event page, so we won't mess up with, you know, searching it through the chat. And as you can see, today's session was like, you know, on also almost no one just was in the silence. It was like constant talking and having fun. So when we get the questions from you to the exact request, we will, you know, be more organized, and there will be more of the things that you want to know already. We don't need
We are still looking at the chat.
But, you know, it's like we let the people going with the conversation. So yeah.
I'm just looking through that. Everything is a remix page, and actually the guy has been doing a lot of videos. A lot of new videos that I think may be cool, so...
Yeah, maybe let's put the link on even
paper. Yeah, I did it already, so...
Okay. Some of the people are asking about the forums, and already I got the question yesterday when I was on the Hangout with people. But, yeah... It's nothing in the, you know... confirmed yet, so
yeah.
Stay tuned, right?
Some people suggested to appoint others to moderate, because that's our main issue, is the moderation. We don't want it to get clogged with crap or, you know, unmoderated.
Yeah, man.
But maybe we can work something out with some people, some of our members who are willing to pitch in with our initiative.
Yeah, maybe we will find out at some point the way to how to handle it. But maybe let's focus on the things that we already announced, like the level up trip and all the other stuff. So
underpants.
We need some time to it. So.
Yep.
Yeah, and we're looking on the beautiful demo of Dave right now.
Nah. It's trash. Yeah, man. It's pure trash.
You don't know what you're saying, man.
Did you ever do studies from just costumes or armors or anything like that, or is that just like visual library that you've built up over the years?
It's just visual. I have such a hard time doing studies. I hate it so much. So I try and find other ways to do it. Like a lot of the reason why I do like the comic book stuff is because it's like a study. I have an excuse and a real purpose in drawing all of the things I'm drawing. Like, it isn't just me doing it because I want to learn. Also, by the end of it, I'll have like a story and things. So that's like a lot of the motivation behind it, is to have a real reason to do the things I'm doing. Mm-hmm. It isn't just me gonna, like, I don't want to just have like a bunch of girls, like, you know, naked girls off Tumblr, and then have like some samurais that I found online. Like, that kind of stuff isn't interesting to me. Like, I get so bored doing it that I actually have a hard time retaining information. So.
Yeah, and the versatility that you have, right? It's like you can do, like, a robot design or, you know, rendering style, some line arts, some characters, some monsters, and mm-hmm. it's all very cool. Just to see that you are versatile with, you know, changing of the subjects, because it's very important, I guess, for the artists. Maybe not all of the people feel that, but personally, I can tell that I have the feeling that I would like to try, you know, everything at some point. So, yeah, as we can see, you just all have in here, so it's great to see.
I mean, like, I like to think that just, you know how some people draw, like, interiors of, like, houses and stuff? It's like to find a creative way of studying that without it being boring. Like, mm-hmm. find a reason why to do that thing. And like, have it serve more than one purpose than to just be a study. Like, learn and at the same time create something that you're proud of. So, like,
yeah,
you can be proud of a study, but yeah.
I totally agree. Mm-hmm. I'm also not a huge fan of studies. Like, it's better to use that information and interpret it into something, you know.
Yeah, I think it's all about the interpretation and understanding it. So when you understand, you are more able to. You can just save time for doing studies and incorporate.
Yeah, but you can. Sometimes you're stupid, you know. Sometimes you're stupid, and you have to understand by studying. So.
Yeah. It's a very mathematical approach.
It's not like we just tell don't do any studies. It's not like this.
But. I'm actually an opposite.
Yeah, you're a study man.
Yeah, I'm a study man, so.
I don't know, like, I think studying is good, but I think you can actually, at the same time, like, I've done a couple of master studies, but I didn't copy the work, I just...
Analyzed, right?
Yeah, I analyzed and did something similar in a similar style, so I was, mm-hmm. you know, like, trying to learn how he used colors or how he used, you know, certain techniques with light and shadow and brush strokes and all that kind of stuff. But at the same time, try to make something.
Yeah, sorry.
No, go ahead. Yeah.
I think it's also about the personality. Yeah, some of the guys like Wojtek that just will tell you that they want to do a studies before, and some of them are want, you know, to including the studies itself in the illustration or concept.
I think it's a matter of, you know, You cannot do study for sake of studying. You have to do a study to understand something, to get an idea, to wrap your hand around, and to actually use it.
Yeah, so you have to have point to do it.
Sometimes, if you are, like, you don't need to paint it to understand it, okay, that's great. You can apply it immediately, because that's what I think study is about, noticing things that you wouldn't be able to notice without staring at this shit for 2 hours.
Yeah.
Because studying is something more than only painting. You just don't need to paint it. You just can observing it and analyzing, and then
knowledge. Yeah, you know, I just prefer without, like, I don't like sitting and staring at shit for 2 hours. I prefer actually sitting and painting.
But if you like listen, I mean, obviously there's no absolutes in anything. There's
yeah,
no one
exactly.
way to do it ever.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's what I was trying to say.
Everyone has their own way, I guess.
Yeah, it's a preference, obviously.
Yeah, yeah, if you listen to like Craig Mullins talk about, I mean, not Craig Mullins, I meant to say Ian McKeag. He talks about just like visualizing it. Like that's what he does. He's like, sit mm-hmm. and visualize, like, what is this thing? What do I really know about this thing? Mm-hmm. Like, get everything you know about that thing out before you jump in and like start studying. Like my thing now is whenever I find myself, like, I'll keep doing whatever it is until I really hit a wall. And as soon as I hit that wall, I know that it's narrowed down enough so that I know exactly mm-hmm. kind of what to study, what my precise like weaknesses mm-hmm. rather than the general weakness. Because like we used to have on the Crimson Daggers, like the blood sports, where you couldn't do just the challenge. You had to do the challenge plus the studies that were directly related to the painting you were doing. And I think that that's like in a generalized way, I think that helps a lot because you're taking the information and then using it right away. You're not just like painting a bird and then never painting a bird again, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And that can sometimes be a problem, I think, is like people who just kind of study because they see other people studying and they don't study with real purpose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe it also helps some people who just feel like doing both at the same time is a little bit too overwhelming. So mm-hmm. they like to, you know, split up how they approach their practice, you know.
Yeah, and it's easy to be in the trap of just mindless copying something, not, you know, actually analyzing and studying it in the way that you can understand it. So it's in, especially in the beginning part.
Mm.
Yeah, and nobody has it figured out. Nobody does. I don't think anybody ever will. I think that's the whole point of life, is just keep fucking doing it. And then eventually you're just dead, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, and then someone else does it. Some kid, and then their kids do it. And then slowly, over millions of years, we learn.
And then we turn into slowly. Chimps. We de-evolve back to chimps.
Yeah, but we still ride horses.
Yep. And we kill James Franco once and for all.
And his brother.
Yep.
Good chocolate.
There's a lot of Russian in the chat today. I can't read half of the comments.
There is no translation of the comments, unfortunately. Maybe they put shit on us.
That's okay.
Yeah, you gotta stop doing this. Everybody's gonna shit talk you guys.
Well, I think we can probably wrap up the session soon. I mean, I don't know if Dave, you wanna shade this guy or.
Yeah, I'm just gonna finish him. I don't care.
Okay. Yeah, we can leave it on.
If you have to go. That's
No. It's just not
like this. We don't want you to stop, right? So it's only up to you.
If you want to finish it, yeah, we can just, you know, let you finish this guy.
Mm-hmm. there's a cool comment.
Okay.
It's so funny how Russians must outline their presence everywhere they go.
Well, a lot of nationalities do that, don't they?
Yeah. I hear the same about Polish guys playing the games. So they are constantly banned. I also like this guy one day. When I play and, you know, put all the time kurwa in the chats. And people hated me. So finally they just banned me. And I stayed alone.
That's such a sad story, man.
Yeah, man. This thief.
Yeah, sorry, I'm just silently painting the goblin.
Yeah, man. I love his face. It's just,
it's awesome.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So much energy in, you know, the smallest point, even like on the skin. And
yeah, he really looks like if he would bite you, you'd get some nasty gangrene or something.
Mm-hmm.
Although his teeth are very white right now.
Mm-hmm. Maybe cleans them, man.
Yeah.
He's a samurai.
Yeah, you got to work with what you've got.
He has pride.
Jesus, they took over the chat.
The Russians?
Yeah, man. It's like every comment is...
Well, we got a revolt. Get them out of here.
I don't know. It's like...
someone is asking if you want to share your brushes, Dave, or do you have them anywhere online, or...
They're really like not my brushes. They're just like a bunch of people's brushes. But the ones I use mainly are like Palang's brushes.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think they're on our website. So just go to the resources and you will find probably the same brushes a lot of times.
Dave has released the camera tutorial. So if you want, I think, get more insights about this process.
Yeah. Have you posted the link?
Not yet. Okay.
I can post it.
All right.
Yeah, I did a tutorial just like going over the general outline of like how to do this stuff. I mean, it's pretty in-depth. It's like 6 hours long.
Wow. Okay. More than an outline.
Yeah, but it's 6 hours of like thoughts too about stuff.
Yeah.
Literally talking for 6 hours, if you can handle that.
We are almost in the half of this amount right now.
Yeah. Yeah, and we've talked for like 100 hours in this damn show.
You don't have to tell me. I think I've done like, I don't even know how many hours of live streams. It's disgusting.
It's just filthy. So many hours.
Oh, sorry.
Are we past 100 hours now? Level up, like, videos?
Probably.
Yeah.
I mean, 43. I don't think many episodes are shorter than 2 hours, maybe a couple of minutes shorter, so.
No, it's always, like, at least, I guess, 2 hours, so.
Anthony Jones was 1 hour and 56 minutes.
He was very precise about going back to his duties.
Yeah, he's very organized, yeah.
We started to stream a bit earlier.
Yeah, so basically level up sessions, if you want to watch them all, it would take you 4 days and 5 hours straight.
Yeah, but through all that mess, there's actually so much knowledge. It's crazy.
Yeah, to be fair, it's all there, so... If you're not lazy, you can find everything that you need to improve or just, you know, get some quick, you know, knowledge.
Not because of us, obviously.
Yeah.
Because of the artists that are on the show and that are sharing their approach and knowledge. Yeah. Every session is totally different. Every artist is totally different. And not many of them share the same approach.
Mm-hmm.
Or even if they do, they show a different one during the session. So it's... really insightful.
Yeah, we just clog it with nonsense.
Yeah, we just, yeah. Oh, shit.
We are here to show your t-shirt.
Yeah.
Not anything else. That's set, by the way.
Basically, the process, to wrap up the process of this is you get your rough liner, then you create a more detailed liner on top, then you fill it in with a flat color, then you fill the every part with its base color, right? And then you shade it, right?
Yeah, color correct and then shade.
What's the effect layer on the line art, the outer glow? Is it to make it feel more organic and pencil-y?
Yeah, I want to just have like a, just kind of like a softer, less digital feel to it, because if I remove it, it looks like this.
So it's kind of almost working a little bit like an ambient occlusion, like a soft local shadow.
Yeah. I don't want it to feel so, like, I don't know, separate. It becomes more integrated into the actual, like, final piece. Like, the it isn't such, like, a stark line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wojtek. You just muted the scrolling, the mouse click.
Yeah, alright, so
it's
Yeti is so sentient.
Yeah.
Right. Good Yeti.
Yeah, the Yeti's, you cannot secretly do stuff anymore. People will hear it very crisply.
Of course. You already test out it, right? Before the session.
Yeah.
So we need to mute ourselves if we want to do something behind.
Fortunately, there's a manual mute on the microphone. You only need one hand to use it.
Yeah.
Super zoned out. This is like the most therapeutic part. Like I had somebody say, like, how come you don't use like the whatever it is, pen tool or something to like fill all this?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, I love every single moment where you have to spend a little more time. Like if you can make artificial time for yourself, at least for me, it helps so much because I know how long this is going to take. So I want to make sure everything's right before I get to it. And the more space I put there, the more thought goes into what I'm doing. I feel like if there's the knowledge that like this is going to take a little bit longer, you know, anytime I can do stuff like that, it helps the whole process of like making it actually cool or something I want to draw. So it doesn't feel like I can just spit things out, even though it might just seem fast. If you're watching it, you're not like, you know, you haven't been doing this for a long time. But for me, it takes a little longer this way. But it's really beneficial to how I go through my whole process. If anybody was wondering why I'm not more like efficient with that stuff.
Trust me, man, you're very efficient. Even though you're doing it, you know, in a clean, meticulous way, you're still very efficient. Experience. Just sound effects of scratching pens on tablets.
Yep.
That's the true art feeling.
That's my mic right there. My mic is literally hanging above the tablet.
Maybe we can create, like, you know those CDs that you can buy, like those arty farty CDs that you can buy where you listen to whale sounds when you sleep?
Maybe we can be crying.
Yeah, we can do something like that with, you know, sounds of, you know, brushes, paint brushes, and pencil scratching on paper.
That actually is super soothing.
Yeah.
To me.
I loved it. Yeah. Some nice chalk on a blackboard.
Just forever. Just going to sleep at night thinking about trolls. I love that. It's the one high-pitched ding.
The sound quality of that cricket is amazing. It's like he's in my ear.
Yeah, that really is pretty good.
Yeah, the silence is beautiful, but to be just, you know, everyone is focused on Dave's progress right now, so there are a lot of just strange comments on chat, so
I think really good ones.
What can us?
No, nothing. Never mind.
Okay.
I'm so zen right now.
Someone is asking if they can count on Photoshop file after the session. PSD, I mean.
Yeah, we're trying to gather all the PSDs. Stop laughing, man. Stop laughing. We're trying to gather all the PSDs from all the artists that we haven't put on the website yet, and we'll try to fix that once and for all with the updated site. We're having some people help us, so... Yeah. Hopefully it'll go better in the future.
All the PSDs? What do you mean?
Yeah.
Well,
the file that you are working on, the people are always, you know, very interested in seeing it. So maybe not to just make them await once more time. So I think it's like about 40 time again. So maybe if you want, David, and when you're going to post it on Facebook, you can also attach the link, the PSD file. So.
That was a long speech, man.
That was a comic relief right there.
That's pull out.
How do you do it, man? Every time.
Yeah, some who's creating a folder at the same time as me? Do you have a Dropbox, Dave?
No.
Against the system.
No, I just don't. Okay. I don't know why I would use it. I never use that stuff. I don't know. Mail it or something.
Yeah, sure. I thought you were being ironic in the beginning, I guess. Yeah, sure. If you could mail it to us, then we'll stick it in the public folder.
But this time for real, right?
Yeah, of course. Pretty soon.
Yeah, I keep everything separate on like all of these PSDs I have, like everything I've ever done, just in case anybody ever wants to like see it. Like never flatten anything.
I find it so tempting to flatten. Like, I really struggle with it. I always want to flatten stuff and then just start painting over it, but regrets most of the time.
Yeah, it's nice to not have, like, the security, though.
In a way, yeah. It makes me feel free if it's flat. Like, I don't know. When there's too many layers, I get into this sort of weird... I feel like I'm doing more like comping. Like,
yeah.
I feel like I'm doing comping job, and I don't really like that feeling.
I think that I have a problem where like it's hard to let it grow organically if there's too many, layers and things. It's like I can almost become nostalgic for the sketch I did like 20 minutes ago.
Yeah.
Where I'm like, oh, that was so much better. I'm just gonna go back to that and just never move on.
Yeah.
your audience isn't bored.
Nope, there's just a lot of Russian talk going on. It's a Russian party.
Okay, good.
I can read Putin War Bogolovka.
Just discussing other topics.
Here's a question for you, Dave. Could you explain a little bit of the process that you used to make the Garen and any art for Riot Games?
Sure. That's a pretty long process, but like what it is I start in grayscale initially with the sketches and things, and then I build up the values that way. And once I feel like they're at an all right level, like they're not like finished or it's not super rendered or anything like that, but when I feel like it reads well, I'll start to drop in colors, and then I'll do like a painting from the colors. I'll do a lot of adjustments on top of that. And most of like what looks finished on those is these little like dotty details I do at the end, which is just to catch light and make things look sharper than they really are. Like it'll be looser than you think, and then I'll do these little like scribbly implied details of like ornate designs and armor or whatever, and then it ends up looking like finished, and then people go like, you know, the whole thing might have taken me 40 hours or something, but and probably not that much, but something pretty long. And by the end of it, they'll be like, oh, those details on that armor. And I'm like, that's the part that took me like 10 minutes at the end. But it's all like implied scribbling. And I mean, it's mostly grayscale to color and then painting up from color, lots of adjustments. And I don't really reference anything. I try and keep it all from my imagination. And then I'll just look at like how I can take the designs that Riot did and make them real, more realistic. So usually that means like adding parts to the designs that make it look more like it was made by somebody.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think that that's kind of like my default approach to it, is make it feel like somebody actually put this thing together. That helps a lot for me.
Yeah. And things like wearing and, you know, erosion or...
Right, anything that makes it feel like they've been in battle or whatever, yeah. Whatever they do, kind of put that history into the design.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Helps ground it in realism. It's kind of like, I used to talk about how I didn't like the Narnia movies because they were wearing, like, brand new armor. Like, everybody was, like...
Yeah, it's too polished, everything. Right?
It's yeah, like, brilliant. It didn't feel... lived in. The whole world didn't feel lived in to me, and it kind of bothered me.
Mm-hmm.
But, I think that's, like, an easy fix for that, is to just add, like, wear and tear to things. It's kind of a cop-out in some ways, because that's, like, what everybody does. It's kind of
easy, but it works, and I think it's fun as well, and I think it's realistic. I mean, if you look at the real world, everything is constantly eroding. Like, we try to keep cities clean, but if you look around, you can see that there's stuff dripping and, you know, like, spots and blotches and rust everywhere. And we just kind of exaggerate that a little bit to give it, you know, extra touch.
You don't want to solely rely on that. That's the only thing. At least for me, it's kind of a trap to only use that as, like, the tool to make it, like, more gritty, real.
Yeah, yeah. I guess it's finding a balance and doing it in the right places, yeah.
It can easily be overdone sometimes. It is very much like a, you know, it was for a while like a trend thing to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you cover everything in dirt.
Yeah, you go into certain styles as well when you do that, you know.
Mm-hmm. This racist cartoon I just drew.
Hello?
Hello.
Oh, sorry, I just had some problems with my speakers.
Somebody just breaking your house.
I was like three times, hello, hello. And I know that I acted like idiot, but it needed to be checked because...
Darek likes to shout.
I used to do it more, I guess, in the past. Like, hello, everybody.
Yeah, you've really calmed down.
Not anymore. I think it also comes with the nerve, being nervous, as you said. That
you start shouting.
Yeah, man. Jesus, level up. Hello.
Yeah.
Oh, man, realizing how dead these are.
Here's another question. Most online workshops are geared towards people who are already intermediate level, but what's your advice for when you're just starting to learn how to draw?
I mean, it's a lot of the fundamentals, so you have to go back to, like, just the heavy lifting, you know. The fun stuff is when you have some of that down. I mean, nobody really nails it. You know, nobody that I know, anyway, unless you're some famous master I've never heard of. But, like, it's an ongoing struggle. But once you can play with those things, then the sort of intermediate stages, those tutorials come into play. And I think those are easier to kind of, like, talk about. But for, you know, the beginning stages, it's all about just using what's in front of you. Like, just start working on the obvious. You know, like, start doing, I mean, not that it's obvious for everybody, but start doing, like, studies from, you know, if you want to do, like, Loomis to do figure drawing or Bridgman, or, I mean, that's all I really did. And I just drew a lot, too, on top of that. And then, you know, grab different materials from around the house. Like, don't wait. Don't, like, give yourself barriers. Like, I think a lot of people go, like, I need to wait till I have all these perfect tools before I can start to learn. And now you don't. Yeah. Just grab, like, a T-shirt, fold it up, study wrinkles. Like, grab a, you know, Coke can, study how, like, light reflects off of it. And then, you know, get a piece of glass, grab a mirror, put a still life on a mirror, like an apple that you bought at the store, plus some other stuff. And then, you know, do a painting of that the best you can. And know, absolutely know, that it's going to be shit when you do it. That's the key, I think, is to just understand that you're never going to be the best when you start out doing that. It's just going to be awful, and accept that, and just let it be bad for a long time. And that's what happened to me. It was like, I couldn't see progress. I hated everything I did. I was like, this is going to go on forever. And then you will eventually hit a breakthrough moment if you don't give up, if you keep doing the terrible stuff. And then when you hit those breakthrough moments, you're going to be like, oh, my God, everything makes sense now. And then immediately after that, nothing's going to make sense. And then you just
then start again. That.
Yeah. Yep.
But I think it's a good advice that you're giving, telling people to actually start with the mindset that you're going to fail. Because if you have that expectation, at least you won't be as disappointed. And it kind of takes off a lot of pressure, because a lot of people quit because they think it's too shit. But if you're already expecting that it's going to be crap, at least you might actually pull through. And then the way that you approach it is just, you know it's going to be crap, but you're going to find out why it's going to be crap. And that's what you're going to learn. You're going to see why you did something wrong by doing it wrong.
Yeah, and it's the misconception that a lot of people have coming into it, that, like, the people that you look up to for some reason didn't have that question in their head going into studying. Like, everybody that you love thought about exactly what you're thinking about right now, and the difference between them and you is that they started and they didn't let it pressure them, and they weren't like, oh my God, that's way too hard. They just started knowing that it was going to be too hard, and then they broke through. But that's it. It's, you have to make a decision, you know, today, because there's never going to be a good time to do it. There's never going to be a moment where all the stars align and you're like, oh, it's perfect. Now I'll start my journey. It's like, it's just going to be shit. So, you know, get used to it, start working on it, understand that it has to be this way, and that every single person you love went through exactly what you're going through. Every single question, every single, like, issue you have, you know, the difference between them and you is that they asked somebody for help, they worked on it, they looked it up, they, you know, they didn't let that stop them. They kept going. So, yeah, and it's just, you're just in the heavy lifting stages.
Yeah, I think patience is a blessing for those kind of people, because that's the problem with most people, is they're not patient and they want to jump in straight away and do all this awesome stuff that they see, but obviously it's impossible, like we've said a billion times. But again, it's how you approach it and your mindset towards it. And if you see it differently, if you see it like a journey where you're going to learn, and be excited about that, you know, be excited about all the steps that you have to take to get to this point, because that's, you know, that's kind of like what life is, you know. It's not, because like Dave was saying before, you know, like you reach a certain point and you're not, maybe not even happy and you want to move on, and it's like an always ongoing process of improving yourself and, you know, looking back at the past and seeing what you can learn from it. And that's actually the beauty of it, I think. I mean, that's what art for me is all about. It's not really about the final product. It's just about the journey of creating and always wanting to create again and again and again, and always trying to improve and try new things and, you know, learn and grow. Yeah.
Yeah, that's like that that thing of people say they want to be somewhere. Like, you know, I'm sure that every single person who's like a self-made, you know, billionaire, millionaire, any of those people, it's like at first they said, I want to be successful, I want to do all those things. But why they don't stop working and why they continue on is because they realize over time that it was never about that. It was never about the money. It was about the journey to that point. And they long for that. And that's what pushes them, is that journey aspect of like, this isn't the goal. It's the whole adventure to it. And then you just make another goal and another goal, and nothing's ever good enough.
Yeah, and that's why it keeps people going, right? For it, and trying to accomplish another thing and another, as you said, with goals and goals. So
yeah, like old guys.
Our human nature, by the way. So, and that's good, because as long as you live, you have the goals. So.
And vodka.
Yeah, and get drunk all the time. It helps so much. Get drunk, hurt the people close to you, move on.
Someone is asking, I don't know if you want to answer this or not,
sure,
if Crimson Daggers will ever come back, or at least something similar to those.
I don't know. It's the whole point of it was to do it until you couldn't do it. Like, do it until it worked enough that I could be a professional, and then hopefully somebody would take over. And then as soon as they became like whatever they wanted to be, or at least like they started down that road and it became impossible to juggle work and the group, that they would pass it on as well. Mm-hmm. But I think it's turned into a lot of different things. I think there's a lot of people, not necessarily that group directly, but like, you know, like you guys do this kind of thing, like other people do other things. It's like there's a bunch of different groups out there that carry on the same kind of traditions.
Mm. Yeah, I can tell we were thinking very heavily about Crimson Daggers when we were thinking about creating Level Up. And
yeah, of course.
It was like the thing we were missing from the times of Crimson Daggers, like it's not alive anymore. We won't get it to we won't be able to run it again because we're not connected anyhow. So at that point where we were, we just decided to do it on our own. So it's really we tried to capture the spirit, casual spirit of the community, created, which influenced and like helped so many great artists right now to become professionals. That it's really crazy.
Yeah.
I was really like impressed by everybody.
I think Alex Nigra still has on his profile that he studied at Crimson Daggers. And look how awesome he is right now.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It was a really good group, and you know, if it wasn't for that support and that community, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing now. Like I literally owe like so much to that group. Mm-hmm. Just, you know, that was my school of discipline, was doing that group, because know, nothing was going to make me do all those studies on my own. Like, I wasn't just going to be able to sit there. I mean, I could, but it wouldn't have been as much. Like, sitting there in a room alone, being totally discouraged and just being like, I have to do all this work and I have to improve, but to just sit here and do it is so, it's such like a daunting thing, and you're the only one telling you you have to do it. Mm-hmm. So the Crimson Daggers was like the way to get past that, the way to like just have a reason to get up in the morning and do the work before doing anything else. And mm-hmm. without that, I wouldn't have done, like, you know, I don't even know. I wouldn't have done anything, or at least not as quickly.
Yeah, we had, you know, almost quite similar idea when we started out. And of course, we, as Wojtek said, we just based as an inspiration on Crimson Daggers. But we really felt that we need to go out to people, you know, in somehow, because the internet has that kind of opportunity that you can. All, maybe not in real life, but you almost met the people, and we just wanted to hang with people every week. So start out something like this, going out of our caves and, you know, see what happens. And yeah. It keeps going, so it's cool, yeah.
It's cool. That's like the idea we had for Crimson Daggers was going to be called Crimson Couches, where you go around the world with, like, people who are willing to let you stay with them in the group, and you go and like hang out like an online, like mm-hmm. hotels kind of thing, but of people who are like willing to help you.
Mhm. Yeah, it's awesome.
That would have been really cool, but it was just like too hard to, at that point, way too hard to juggle everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're already having a hard time sometimes juggling everything.
Of course.
Someday some young Padawan is going to have to take over from us.
But and imagine not, doing level up onto yes. our 50s.
Huh?
Imagine doing level up onto our 50s.
Are you mad? Yeah. there's no way. Like, we will have said everything so many times that we'll probably end up in a mental institution. Values, yeah. Values.
Yeah, I'm quite curious what's happened, you know, like in the next couple of years. We still don't have even 1 year behind level up. It's almost 1 year, but it's like a long time that all of the things happen, and it's awesome. So it's quite difficult to just think in the future about it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and why should we? I mean, we'll find out. That's going to be the fun part, you know. We have no idea now. I mean, so many things happen in life. Like, sometimes things happen to me, and I just think back, and I say, like, there's no way that I could have ever imagined that this would happen. But that's what makes life so awesome and exciting.
Yeah. And just, something is, you know, sometimes it's going unpredictable.
Yeah.
It's also good. If it's good, or of course, but...
Yeah.
I remember telling my friend Dan that I never wanted to be a concept artist ever. I was like, you try and do that job. I was like, I'm not going to fucking do that. It sounds so boring. Now that's like, that's what I do now. It's like weird. Everything changes.
Yeah.
I never thought I would live in Germany. That's one of the things that I never thought. Because my grandfather fought in the war, and I was raised to, you know, dislike Germans. So I was like, yeah, I would never go live there. But now I'm an adult, and I understand that things are not black and white. And I loved living there. It was amazing.
And now you're there fighting the war for your grandfather.
No, I actually live in England now. But another country that I never thought I'd live in, because I was also raised to believe that, you know, all our neighboring countries are actually assholes. You know, you tend to always hate the country that's bordering you when you don't know any better. Kind of what... It's kind of what most people do when they are a bit ignorant about the world.
Goddamn Mexicans.
There you go. And Canadians.
Yeah.
Well, you're lucky.
What about those people?
Yeah, see, Dave only borders two countries. We border 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, 5 countries, so it's a lot of hate.
Whoops. Yeah, I think I'm about done with these dudes.
Awesome. Yeah,
it looks outstanding, so.
Thanks.
It's like Star Evil life on level up.
It's so much more than I have ever expected from such a short demo. Yeah, it's awesome. All right, so thank you. Thank you very much for joining us today. It was awesome, very insightful to see your workflow and share your thoughts. Yeah, it was awesome. All right, so we'll upload the PSD if you are willing to share it, of course. Mm-hmm. Feel free to post this to our event page or wherever you want. That would be great. Guys, stay tuned for another event next week. We'll post an info soon. And thanks, Dave. Thanks again. Really means a lot.
Thank you guys for having me.
Thanks, man. It was awesome.
Yeah.
Bye, guys.
See you guys next time. See you guys next week.
Bye-bye.
Yep. Bye, everyone.